Baik, kita mulai saja, Bapak dan Ibu yang terhormat, peserta seminar sesi paralel di ruang 6. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat siang, salam sejahtera untuk kita semua. Sebelumnya perkenalkan, nama saya Indrawan. Saya akan memandu jalannya sesi diskusi paralel di ruang ini ya. Ada 10 pemateri di ruang ini, tapi beberapa ada yang mengonfirmasi untuk tidak mengikuti seminar. Jadi peserta yang tidak mengikuti sesi presentasi akan langsung di apa namanya langsung dicoret dan langsung posisi di bawahnya itu langsung otomatis menempati tempat ya yang sudah dijadwalkan. Baik, sesi pertama akan berlangsung selama 1 jam, terdiri dari 3 pemateri, yaitu ada Bapak Anto Rizaldi. Saya sudah melihat Bapak Anto, selamat siang Bapak. Kemudian Bapak Bayu Aji tidak mengikuti sesi presentasi. Kemudian Bapak Dari Dalan akan diwakilkan oleh tim penelitinya, kebetulan sudah hadir secara ruling. Dan siap-siap untuk Mas Theodoric ya, untuk naik satu sesi ya. Jadi di sesi pertama Mas Theodor naik ke atas ya. Semua presentasi akan saya yang apa namanya share screen kan, akan saya bagikan. Ini sudah ada punyanya Mas Theodor, saya buka dulu. Kemudian tadi Pak Anto, saya buka juga. Dan ada Rizka, saya buka juga. Baik, jadi sesi paralel akan berlangsung tiga pemakalah dalam satu sesi. Kemudian masing-masing peserta atau ketiga pemateri tersebut akan memaparkan materinya kurang lebih selama 15 menit. Kemudian ada sisa waktu setengah jam. Ada sisa waktu 15 menit untuk sesi diskusi. Jadi satu sesi itu berlangsung selama sekitar 1 jam. Baik, semoga sudah terbuka. Oh, ini baru terbuka satu. Masih dalam proses 2 dan 3. Oke, baik. Untuk sesi pertama, saya persilakan kepada Bapak Anto Rizaldi dari Universitas mana nih PowerPoint-nya? Oke, dari Universitas Negeri Malang. Baik, kepada Bapak Anto saya persilahkan. Saya share screen kan. Baik, semoga sudah bisa terlihat.
Baik, bisa Mas. Maaf, bisa Pak.
Siap.
Saya mulai ya. Saya mulai. Baik, apakah suara saya terdengar?
Iya, jelas Pak.
Jelas, oke. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi.
Selamat siang dan salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Baik, pada kesempatan kali ini, saya Anto Rizaldi, mahasiswa pasca sarjana Fakultas Sastra Pendidikan Bahasa Indonesia Universitas Negeri Malang, izin memaparkan penelitian saya dengan dosen saya, yakni Prof. Wahyudi Siswanto dan Dr. Taufik Darmawan, tapi beliau tidak bisa ikut bergabung karena ada kesibukan, jadi saya yang akan mempresentasikan. Penelitian ini berjudul Komunitas Sastra Pinggiran sebagai Penggerak Dinamika dan Dialektika Sastra di Indonesia. Lanjut, Pak. Oke. Jadi yang melatar belakangi penelitian saya ada 3 poin. Yang pertama adalah terkait komunitas sastra yang ada di Indonesia, sebagian besarnya memerlukan perhatian yang serius, terutama komunitas sastra pinggiran. Karena apa? Komunitas sastra pinggiran ini bisa dibilang komunitas sastra yang tidak dianggap lah, katakan seperti itu. Dan sebenarnya komunitas sastra pinggiran ini juga muncul di tengah-tengah masyarakat sebagai sebuah ekstase. Ekstase ini adalah sebuah kesadaran, kesadaran yang dimiliki oleh seorang. Berikutnya terkait komunitas sastra pinggiran memiliki hubungan sumbangsih yang cukup signifikan dalam menumbuh kembangkan karakter dan dinamika kreativitas di masyarakat daerah. Karena apa? Komunitas sastra pinggiran ini biasanya didirikan dan dijumpai oleh masyarakat pada masyarakat yang ingin melestarikan sastra lokalnya, sastra setempatnya, seperti itu. Berikutnya, terkait konsep pinggiran itu sendiri merupakan komunitas yang dijalankan dan muncul dari masyarakat yang berada di wilayah atau yang biasa disebut komunitas sastra wilayah. Jadi komunitas sastra pinggiran bisa disebut sebagai komunitas sastra wilayah. Akan tetapi di dalam penelitian saya ini memfokuskan kepada komunitas sastra pinggiran seperti itu. Lanjut, Pak. Oke. Komunitas sastra pinggiran yang saya jumpai dan yang saya teliti di wilayah Provinsi Jawa Timur sebenarnya banyak sekali komunitas sastra pinggiran. Tetapi saya fokuskan ke di kota Surabaya. Di kota Surabaya itu ada komunitas Surabaya Putri, Poetry, maaf, Sajak Liar, Kopi Aksara, komunitas sastra luar pagar yang dimiliki oleh UNER, kemudian Bengkel Muda Surabaya, komunitas Sikar Merah, Forum Sastra Bersama Surabaya, dan lain sebagainya. Jadi Bapak-Ibu dapat melihat di PowerPoint saya ada contoh dokumentasi komunitas sastra pinggiran. Ada, dan komunitas sastra pinggiran ini sebenarnya memiliki hubungan ya atau relasi antara komunitas satu dengan komunitas satu yang lainnya. Karena apa? Sering melakukan bekerja sama dalam melakukan pertunjukan seperti itu. Lanjut, Pak. Oke. Berikutnya terkait metode penelitian yang saya gunakan. Pertama adalah pendekatan penelitian deskriptif, jenisnya kualitatif. Datanya berupa komunitas sastra pinggiran di wilayah Surabaya. Sumber datanya saya mengambil dari Balai Pemuda, tepatnya Komunitas Bengkel Muda, Universitas Airlangga tadi, Universitas PG Adibana Surabaya, dan UNESA, seperti itu. Dan pengumpulan data saya melakukan dengan teknik wawancara dan observasi. Berikutnya terkait analisis data, saya berfokus pada 3 poin. Yang pertama adalah peran komunitas sastra pinggiran. Berikutnya dialektika kesusastraan Indonesia. Dan yang terakhir adalah basis komunitas sastra pinggiran. Lanjut, Pak. Oke, jadi terkait peran komunitas sastra pinggiran, komunitas sastra pinggiran itu terbentuk dari komunitas. Saya contohkan adalah Kopi Aksara ya. Jadi Kopi Aksara ini bekerjasama dengan kampus S1 saya dulu di Universitas PG Adibuana Surabaya, sering mengadakan kolaborasi acara bareng seperti itu. Jadi ketika dulu belum pandemi masih dilakukan acara secara langsung ya. Kalau sekarang secara virtual. Jadi ada 2 contoh ya. Jadi secara langsung yang dulu tahun 2020 itu ada alamat baru, dengan yang baru-baru ini Kopi Aksara melakukan orkestrasi kata-kata secara virtual seperti itu. Lanjut, Pak. Oke, terkait dialektika kesusastraan Indonesia, di sini dipaparkan keberagaman gaya estetika atau keindahan dari komunitas itu sendiri. Ya, saya ambil contoh genre estetik puisi gelap yang sampai saat ini dipopulerkan, keberadaannya dibawakan oleh Indra Cahyadi yang merupakan anggota dari Komunitas Sastra Pinggiran FS3LP. Ini milik UNESA. seperti itu. Jadi menyambung pernyataan tadi yang sebelumnya bahwa komunitas sastra yang dimiliki oleh beberapa kampus atau universitas yang ada di Surabaya itu bekerjasama baik terkait pemerintahan, yakni dinaungi oleh Balai Pemuda Surabaya, yakni Pinggel Muda, maupun antar univ seperti itu. Lanjut, Pak. Oke. Basis komunitas sastra pinggiran di wilayah Surabaya sendiri khususnya komunitas sastra pinggiran itu tadi ada banyak sekali, tetapi saya ambil yang masih eksis, bisa dibilang seperti itu, yakni Tikar Merah UINSA, Universitas Islam Negeri Sunan Ampel, kemudian komunitas Kopi Aksara yang berkolaborasi dengan Unipa Surabaya, komunitas Lembu Sore, UNESA juga, kemudian FSL3LP, maaf tadi keliru, yakni UNER, bukan UNESA ya. Jadi terkait basis komunitas sastra pinggiran yang ada di Surabaya itu lebih ke arah religius. Jadi dapat di PowerPoint ini saya berikan contoh ya. Jadi pementasan sastra itu bertemakan secara religius, baik itu secara agama Islam maupun non agama Islam seperti itu. Dan terkait komunitas sastra pinggiran ini basisnya itu sangat banyak ya, sangat luas dan tentunya memiliki relasi, jadi antara saling kerjasama antara satu kampus misalkan acara bareng, baik itu acara bedah buku, novel maupun pertunjukan maupun ngamen, kalau orang Surabaya adalah ngamen sastra yang biasanya dilakukan di
mohon maaf ada kendala jaringan, saya lanjut ya Mas Anto
ya. Silakan, Pak. Ya,
mohon maaf. Tadi sampai di sini ya.
Kesimpulan.
Oh, sudah sampai kesimpulan.
Ya, oke.
Monggo-monggo.
Baik. Yeah. Jadi dari penelitian yang saya lakukan beserta dosen saya, ada 3 poin sebenarnya yang bisa diperoleh, yakni terkait Jawa Timur sendiri itu memiliki gudangnya ya, gudang karya sastra. Jadi banyaknya tersebarnya komunitas sastra pinggiran yang ada di Jawa Timur yang tadi saya sebutkan adalah salah satu contoh sastra pinggiran di kota Surabaya. Dan berikutnya terkait Jawa Timur merupakan apa ya, segudang ya komunitas sastra pinggiran yang aktif, masih aktif dan mampu membawa serta melahirkan calon penerus atau sastrawan, saya bilangnya seperti itu, yang nantinya melahirkan karya-karya yang monumental. Jadi para sastrawan, calon sastrawan membuat karyanya walaupun tadi tidak sampai nasional, tapi secara lingkup wilayah karya-karya mereka diakui. Jadi para teman-teman sastrawan ini, calon sastrawan ini membuat antologi puisi, antologi cerpen, kemudian didiskusikan. Kalau di Surabaya dibilang kenduri ilmi atau kenduri ilmu seperti itu. Jadi dibedah karya sastranya, kemudian melakukan tanya jawab, kemudian melakukan kritik, dikritiki apa kelemahan dan kelebihannya seperti itu. Terkait poin yang terakhir adalah komunitas sastra pinggiran mampu menjadi basis estetika atau keindahan bagi kesusastraan Indonesia. Dikarenakan dari hal-hal yang kecil, maka nantinya akan membawa dampak perubahan yang besar bagi bangsa Indonesia, kesusastraan di Indonesia seperti itu. Terima kasih. Mohon maaf apabila ada kesalahan dan kekurangan dalam penyampaian materi saya. Saya akhiri wabillahi taufiq. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih Mas Anto yang sudah memaparkan penelitiannya. Menarik sekali ya, bagaimana kita bisa melihat bahwa komunitas-komunitas sastra tersebut akan mampu membawa perubahan besar bagi kesusastraan di Jawa Timur khususnya dan di Indonesia pada umumnya. Baik, semoga penelitian Mas Anto dan dosennya ini dilancarkan. Ini penelitian untuk tesis kah, Mas?
Oh, bukan, Mas.
Oh, jadi bukan ini, ya, penelitian mandiri saja ya, bersama dosen ya. Ya,
semoga mata kuliah sastra.
Ah, oke. Okay. Baik. Kita lanjut saja kepada pemateri yang kedua. Pemateri kedua ini merupakan tim dari Fakultas Ilmu Budaya Universitas Mula Warman. Ada 3 peneliti di dalamnya. Yang pertama ada Bapak Dahri Dahlan, kemudian ada ada Ibu Irma Suraya Hanum, SSMPD, yang tadi memandu jalannya pembukaan, dan ada Rizka Meliana yang merupakan mahasiswi Fakultas Ilmu Budaya Universitas Mula Warman. Presentasi akan dilakukan oleh Rizka ya, Rizka. Baik, kepada Rizka langsung saja saya persilakan, ini saya arahkan dulu kameranya.
Cek.
Monggo, Rizka.
Cek. Baik, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Perkenalkan, nama saya Rizka Meliana, perwakilan dari tim peneliti saya. Di sini saya akan mempresentasikan penelitian yang berjudul Eksploitasi Hutan dan Kumpulan Puisi Anak, Pohon-Pohon Raksasa di Rimba Nusantara, karya Cory Lyon Rampan. Baik, selanjutnya. Jadi yang pertama adalah yang melatar belakangi penelitian ini, Kalimantan menjadi salah satu hutan lindung terbesar di Indonesia. Realitas situasi dan kondisi hutan Kalimantan Timur telah dihancurkan oleh penebang-penebang ilegal dan pertambangan dan pembangunan perumahan. Sehingga kondisi ini sangat dapat menyebabkan hutan tidak berfungsi sebagaimana mestinya. Belum lagi kebakaran hutan yang melanda di hutan dan lahan di daerah Kalimantan. Sehingga kondisi sebagian hutan di beberapa kabupaten di Kalimantan Timur ini sangat memprihatinkan. Sehingga hutan Kalimantan ini sudah seharusnya menjadi sorotan dan perhatian bagi kita.
Pak, suaranya hilang tuh, Pak. Kayaknya.
Coba.
Cek. Lagi. Cek.
Agak keras, coba.
Cek.
Aman, Pak, aman.
Masuk ya? Oke. Okay.
Ya.
Lanjut ya. Tadi ya, eksploitasi bagian yang menarik untuk dibahas. Pasalnya anak-anak mempelajari kondisi hutan Kalimantan lewat karya sastra. Jadi setiap karya sastra yang dihasilkan oleh pengarang ini mempunyai unsur-unsur keindahan yang berbeda. Unsur-unsur tersebut dapat terbentuk dalam karya sastra yang dimunculkan oleh pengarang itu sendiri. Lalu puisi anak, penelitian ini menggunakan kumpulan puisi anak yang berjudul Pohon-Pohon Raksasa di Rimba Nusantara karya Cory Lyon Rampan. Lalu, Cory berusaha menggerakkan pembaca dengan cara yang samar-samar, tetapi mampu meningkatkan rasa hormat dan penghormatan terhadap hutan Kalimantan. Jadi, ide-ide Cory ini dalam kumpulan puisi ingin berusaha membangkitkan emosi jiwa yang dirangsang oleh hal-hal yang ada di peristiwa di Kalimantan, kehidupan di hutan Pulau Kalimantan. Jadi berdasarkan latar belakang ini, maka penelitian ini sangat penting dan menarik untuk dilakukan. Maka penelitian ini mengambil judul Eksploitasi Hutan dalam kumpulan puisi anak Pohon-Pohon di Rimba Nusantara karya Cory Lyon Rampan. Selanjutnya, rumusan masalahnya, bagaimana citra pohon dalam kumpulan puisi anak Pohon-Pohon Raksasa di Rimba Nusantara karya Cory Lyon Rampan. Lalu yang kedua, bagaimana potensi eksploitasi terhadap pohon dalam kumpulan puisi anak Pohon-Pohon Raksasa di Rimba Nusantara karya Cory Lyon Rampan. Lalu tujuan penelitiannya adalah mendeskripsikan citra pohon dalam kumpulan puisi anak Pohon-Pohon Raksasa di Rimba Nusantara karya Cory Lyon Rampan. Dan yang kedua, mendeskripsikan potensi eksploitasi terhadap pohon dalam kumpulan puisi anak Pohon-Pohon Raksasa di Rimba Nusantara karya Cory Lyon Rampan. lalu manfaat secara teoritis memberikan pengetahuan baru bagi perkembangan ilmu sastra, terutama dalam kajian karya sastra yang menggunakan teori puisi, diksi, citra, dan sastra anak. Lalu secara praktis, bagi pembaca diharapkan dapat menunjang pembentukan potensi pengajaran mengeksploitasi hutan dalam menjalani kehidupan di daerah hutan hujan tropis Kalimantan. Jadi bagi peneliti berikutnya dapat memberikan masukan dalam mengeksploitasi hutan di dalam karya sastra. Selanjutnya, landasan teori. Jadi Pradopo memaparkan bahwa puisi itu mengekspresikan pemikiran yang membangkitkan perasaan, yang merangsang imajinasi, panca indera dalam susunan yang berirama. Jadi semua itu merupakan sesuatu yang penting yang direkam dan diekspresikan, dinyatakan dengan menarik dan memberi kesan. Selanjutnya diksi. Diksi adalah pilihan kata. Dalam konteks sastra, diksi dikaitkan dengan pilihan kata dalam sajak atau puisi. Menciptakan nilai estetika. Diksi digunakan untuk meningkatkan atau menciptakan nilai estetika dari segi struktur tekstualnya, dari aspek bunyi yang puitis bila diucapkan atau dibacakan. Diksi yang demikian itu disebut dengan diksi puitis. Lalu citraan atau imaji. Imaji dapat dimaknai sebagai kata atau rangkaian kata yang mampu menggugah pembayangan dan pengalaman indera para pembacanya. Imaji berkaitan erat dengan bahasa kias, diksi, dan lambang. Lalu sastra anak, menurut Kurniawan, ada dua aspek. Yang pertama, bahasa yang digunakan dalam sastra anak adalah bahasa yang mudah dipahami anak, yaitu bahasa yang sesuai dengan tingkat perkembangan dan pemahaman anak. Lalu yang kedua, pesan yang disampaikan berupa nilai-nilai, moral, dan pendidikan yang sesuai pada tingkat perkembangan dan pemahaman anak. Selanjutnya, definisi konseptual. Penten ini menggunakan kumpulan puisi yang berjudul Pohon-Pohon Raksasa di Rimba Nusantara. Jadi ada tiga puisi. Puisi pertama berjudul Meranti Bunga, Manggeris, dan Ulin. Lalu yang kedua, penten ini akan menganalisis puisi, tiga puisi tadi, untuk menemukan potensi eksploitasi hutan dengan menggunakan teori puisi, diksi, citra, dan sastra anak. Lalu, penten ini menggunakan karya Kori Layun Rampan yang merupakan salah satu sastrawan di Kalimantan Timur. Lalu metode penelitian, penelitian yang digunakan yaitu penelitian kepustakaan. Pendekatan penelitiannya yakni deskriptif kualitatif. Waktu penelitiannya disetujui proposal penelitian sampai bulan Agustus 2020. Data dan sumber data berupa teks, kata, kalimat, dan paragraf yang ada di dalam puisi. Lalu sumber datanya ialah tiga puisi yang terdapat dalam kumpulan puisi anak Pohon-Pohon Raksasa di Rimba Nusantara, karya Kori Layun Rampan. Untuk teknik pengumpulan data, jadi yang pertama adalah menghimpun data. Data dalam hal ini diperoleh setelah membaca berulang-ulang tiga puisi dalam kumpulan puisi anak. Lalu mengklasifikasi data, data yang telah dicatat dan diinventarisasi kemudian dianalisis. Selanjutnya menganalisis data. Data kemudian dipaparkan, disertai dengan penafsiran dan mendeskripsikannya. Terakhir, simpulan. Teknik analisis data, metode analisis ini digunakan untuk memahami cara pengarang untuk menyampaikan gagasan, ide-ide, sikap, perilaku pengarang dalam menampilkan potensi pengajaran mengeksploitasi hutan sehingga membangun totalitas untuk totalitas bentuk maupun makna yang terdapat dalam metode ini. Selanjutnya hasil pembahasan. Data satu yaitu meranti bunga. Jadi di bait pertama, sebelum pohonku ditebang sebagai barang dagang zaman dulu, orang mengenalku penghasil damar baru. Meranti bunga namaku sebagai Sorea leprosula. Sukuku adalah Diopterosarpacea yang masuk kelompok meranti merah juga. Batangku tinggi dan diameterku lebar. Tubuhku pun menyebar, gunaku banyak sekali sehingga aku diekspor ke luar negeri. Dijadikan perabot rumah tangga, aku dikenal di mana-mana. Dijadikan lantai dan kayu lapis, aku tampak permai lagi necis. Di samping Kalimantan dan Sumatera, aku tumbuh di Thailand dan Malaysia. Di budidaya aku gampang juga sehingga aku disukai umat manusia. Tanamlah aku dari biji atau Tunggul Anakan, jika curah hujan cukup tinggi, aku akan tumbuh subur dari bulan ke bulan. Rampan 2008, halaman 57. Jadi pada bait pertama di atas, pembaca sudah menemukan citraan bahwa pohon ini sebagai objek estetika dalam puisi ini yang memiliki posisi yang sangat strategis untuk dieksploitasi. Lalu pada penjelasan awal, kondisi pohon dalam hal ini, pohon meranti bunga digambarkan sebagai penghasil damar dalam kondisi paling naturalnya yang sebelum ditebang. Dan pohon kedua, dan yang kedua, kondisi fungsional berikutnya sebagai barang yang diperdagangkan. Jadi, selanjutnya pada bait ketiga, pohon meranti bunga, awalnya pohon yang digambarkan secara anatomis, batang yang tinggi serta lebar, terus dicitrakan dengan sangat verbal di kalimat pertama tadi, lalu digambarkan pada baris kedua, pohon tersebut tumbuh subur dan menyebar ke berbagai tempat. Kalimat berikutnya, pohon kembali digambarkan sebagai objek yang fungsional. Jadi gunaku banyak sekali. Kalimat terakhir dengan bunyi, sehingga aku diekspor ke luar negeri. Itu untuk data pertama. Selanjutnya data kedua, puisi yang berjudul Manggeris, pohonku yang tinggi tegak lurus. Sebagai barang dagang, lebah madu senang bersarang di dahanku, membiarkan madu dan tempayak yang enak rasanya. Namaku Manggeris atau Compassia excels, termasuk ke dalam suku Caesalpiniaceae untuk keperluan perkapalan dan jendela, aku dipakai di mana-mana. Tumbuhku di Kalimantan dan Sumatera, menyebar juga ke Malaysia Utara untuk bahan bangunan dan rangka pintu. Aku siap dipakai setiap waktu. Ada yang membuat pohonku jadi lesung, tempat para wanita menumbuk padi, ada yang menggergajiku dijadikan papan lantai, khususnya untuk rumah-rumah panggung. Kayuku keras dan susah ditebang, sering merusak mata gergaji. Aku sering dijadikan kayu bakar dan arang, tempat orang menempa besi atau menanak nasi. Rampan 2018, halaman 61. Nah, di analisis data kedua, ini penggalan bait pertama di atas ini memperlihatkan citra pohon manggeris yang diklaim secara verbal sebagai barang dagang. Jadi, kalimat berikutnya memperlihatkan kondisi alami atau ciri lain dari pohon manggeris yang disukai oleh hewan lebah. Untuk bersarang dan mengembangbiakan madu dan tempayak. Hal ini menunjukkan adanya kontradiksi, bahkan tragedi. Selanjutnya penggalan puisi pada bait ketiga juga memperlihatkan pemanfaatan pohon manggeris di ranah domestik. Kayu manggeris memang dikenal tahan dan kuat, tetapi penggambaran berikut ini menunjukkan bahwa kekuatan itu justru menjadi hal yang buruk. Selanjutnya, data tiga, puisi yang berjudul Ulin. Aku disebut kayu ulin, nama lainku kayu besi, karena aku memang keras seperti besi. Dalam ilmu tumbuh-tumbuhan, aku dikenal dengan nama Theosidorosilon zuageri. Sering juga orang menyebut aku Bomean ironwood, yaitu kayu besi dari Pulau Borneo. Daun mudaku berwarna merah ungu, buahku keras seperti batu, kekuatan dan keawetanku kelas satur, sehingga aku bagus untuk kapal dan perahu. Batangku bagus untuk sirap dan lantai, untuk tiang listrik dan telepon, tiang rumah atau balok pelabuhan sebagai konstruksi berat aku tahan. Oleh kelembapan, oleh suhu, oleh serangga penggerak batang, tak ada yang bisa menyerangku, bahkan aku sulit dipaku dan digergaji. Sebagai alat rumah, aku pasti disebut mewah, dan tangan aku pasti disebut cantik dan antik. Karena aku sangat berharga, pantaslah aku dibudidaya. Rampan 2008, halaman 77. Nah, analisis data ketiga, ini deskripsi awal tentang kayu ulin di dalam puisi ini digambarkan sebagaimana style atau cara yang telah digunakan oleh pengarang untuk dua puisi yang sama sebelumnya. Pengarang masih memandang pohon sebagai objek estetis natural. Simbol-simbol seperti sirap, tiang listrik, telepon, pelabuhan, dan bahkan konstruksi alat berat telah memperlihatkan bagaimana fungsi pohon sebagai sesuatu yang harus memenuhi kebutuhan manusia. secara sepihak. Artinya alam tidak memberikan apapun selain manusia mengambil darinya. Jadi kayu ulin dibudidaya untuk memenuhi kebutuhan manusia. Sampai saat ini kayu ulin semakin langka dan jikapun ada manfaatnya hanya untuk memenuhi hasrat konsumtif manusia. Terutama pada dunia industri di dalam dan di luar negeri. Simpulannya, setelah dilakukan analisis, diperoleh simpulan bahwa pada dasarnya, objek yang menjadi topik dari puisi yang berjudul Meranti Bunga, Manggeris, dan Ulin adalah representasi dari hutan. Bahkan bisa disebut pohon sebagai representasi alam. Sehingga menyebut nama pohon tertentu seperti Meranti Bunga, Manggeris, dan Ulin hanya sebuah simbol untuk membicarakan alam di Kalimantan Timur. Dan dari penelitian ini juga dapat disimpulkan bahwa puisi ini hanya dibahas pada dasarnya tidak tepat jika digolongkan sebagai puisi anak yang baik karena ada beberapa di baris dalam puisi tersebut menggunakan istilah-istilah asing yang tidak dipahami oleh pembaca anak. Lalu saran, penelitian ini adalah langkah awal untuk menjadi sebuah pembuka jalan untuk penelitian berikutnya. Diharapkan penelitian yang lebih serius untuk data yang sama dan sumber data yang sama, agar ditemukan hasil penelitian yang lebih baik. Sekian, terima kasih. Kurang lebihnya mohon dimaafkan. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Ya, terima kasih kepada Rizka yang sudah mewakili tim penelitiannya telah memaparkan hasil telaahnya terhadap tiga puisi karya Kori ya sebagai salah satu sastrawan besar yang dimiliki oleh Kalimantan Timur. Baik, selanjutnya saya persilahkan kepada Theodoric Manulang yang akan memaparkan makalahnya yang berjudul Relationship Between Human and Environment Using Ecocritism in the Legacy of Hiorat, novel by Larry Niven, Jerry Pornell, and Stephen Barnes. Baik, kepada Theo, sudah hadir Theo?
Cek ya, hadir Pak.
Oh, saya belum share screen ya, sebentar. Saya share screen dulu. Theodore, ya. Ya, baik. Silakan untuk memulai presentasinya. Boleh dalam bahasa Inggris atau juga bisa disesuaikan dengan bahasa Indonesia. Silakan.
Baik, Pak. Okay, I will start the presentation in title Relationship Between Human and Environment Using Ecocriticism in the Legacy of Europe Novel by Larry Niven, Jerry Pornell, and Stephen Barnes. Lanjut, Pak.
Bentar.
Okay. First chapter is introduction. I will start with background of the research. Nowadays, the environmental disaster becomes a major concern for this planet. The most striking reason for environmental disaster is because rapid exploitation and increasing energy consumption that leads to environmental degradation. Many authors have expressed their concern for nature. The destruction of environment raised concern of many departments and disciplines to put their concern toward text and literary work. Lanjut, Pak. Okay, I will begin to explain about the synopsis about the novel. The title of the novel is The Legacy of Europe, The Legacy of Europe by Larry Niven, Jerry Pornell, and Stephen Barnes. The synopsis is The Legacy of Europe story is about 200 people from Earth that travel light years away to reach Avalon planet to make their settlement on the planet. The arrival of humans has upset the ecology of Avalon. A dangerous predator called Grendel lurk and kill them one by one. Lanjut, Pak. And based on the synopsis and the background, I formulate two research questions. First is, how is the relationship between human and the environment that represent in the legacy of the novel affect the ecology of Avalon? And the second research question is, what is the main character behavior toward nature to reestablish the ecology of Avalon? And the objective of this research is, first, to find out the relationship between humans and the environment that affect the ecology of Avalon. And the second objective is to find out the behavior of the main character toward nature to reestablish the ecology of Avalon. Lanjut, Pak. and my significance of study. First is theoretically, this research can give information and understanding of the theory of ecocriticism portrayed in the novel. And practically, the result of this research can be a reference to analyze another novel based on the environment and nature. And I make two limitations of this research. First, the scope of this research. The researcher focused on the legacy of Europe novel by Larry Niven, Jerry Pournelle, and Stephen Barr. And the second limitation is the researcher focused on analyzing the relationship between humans and environment using ecocriticism concept by Greg Garrett, which are pastoral, wilderness, and animal. The researcher also used the intrinsic element of novel, which is character and characterization, to analyze the behavior of the main character towards nature. Selanjutnya, Pak. Next is definition of key terms. First is ecocriticism. Ecocriticism is the study between literature and physical environment. Ecology is interaction of organism or living creature with the environment. Keystone species is a species that has a high impact on environment, such as controlling other species population. And The Legacy of Europe is a novel written by Larry Niven, Jerry Pournelle, and Stephen Barnes that published on February 4, 2020, about 200 people from Earth that travel light years away to reach Avalon and destroy its ecology. Lanjut, Pak. Chapter 2 is review of related literature. I will explain about novel. Novel is a piece of prose fiction of reasonable length. Novel is classified into one of literary genre, which is called fiction. And the term of fiction is commonly used to describe prose works that tell a story. For example, fairy tales, short story, and novel. Now I will explain about character and characterization. Based on Forster, characters are classified into flat character and round character. A flat character is a character that has only one or two personality traits. And round character is a character that has multiple personality traits and thus more like real people. And characterization is describing the behavior of the character. First is direct method. The direct method means the author tells directly to the reader that character's behavior in the literary works. And indirect method means the author shows the character's behavior through the dialogue about one another. The author can also show characterization through character, thoughts or speech, and action. Lanjut, Pak. Now I will explain about ecocriticism. Ecocriticism is about the study of relationship between literature and physical environment. And ecocriticism and literature by Greg Garrett, there are several concepts of ecocriticism based on Greg Garrett. Those concepts are pastoral, wilderness, and animal. First, I will explain about pastoral. Pastoral concept is focused on relationship between human and environment, which portray distinction between urban and rural area, landscape of nature, and agrarianism that appear in literary work. Next is wilderness. Wilderness is signifying nature as a state of uncontaminated by civilization. Wilderness is a place to protect particular habitats and species. Next is concept of the animal. The concept of animal is focused on relation between human and animal, which is important part of nature. Species extinction is one of the biggest concern. The mass extinction is mainly caused by human. The arrival of human settler is the main cause of species extinction. Lanjut, Pak. For preview study, I use three preview study for my research. First is an ecocritical analysis of nature condition and environmental in G.R.R. Tolkien's The Hobbit. The second preview study is an analysis of human-nature relationship in Children's Julie by Jane Craighead George. And next preview study is an ecocritical analysis of young adult dystopian novel in Veronica Rossi, Under the Never Sky. Lanjut. Next is chapter 2, which is research method. I will explain about research design. In this research, the researcher used qualitative method. The researcher analyzed the novel based on the dialogue between character and the narration. Gottfeldy states that ecocriticism approach began with an interest in representation and examination of how nature is depicted in literature. Next is data and source of data. The source of data is the novel of The Legacy of Europe by Larry Niven, Jerry Pournelle, and Stephen Barr. And the data of this research are narration and quotation. The dialogue and narration are taken from The Legacy of Europe novel. lanjut Pak. Data collection, the researcher use three steps to collect the data. The first step is to read the legacy of your novel to get the general idea of the story. And the second step is to reread the legacy of your novel to find out the narration and quotation that shows the relationship between human and animals that affect the environment. The third step is to observe the obtained data and use the ecocriticism theory and preview study to support the analysis. Next is data analysis. Sebelumnya Pak? Ya. By using the principle and practice of textual analysis exposed by ecocriticism, ecocritic concern about nature, humanity, and environment. The researcher analyzed the legacy of their novel that is related to the research question. First, the researcher used the concept of ecocriticism to show the relationship between human and environment that can affect the ecology of Avalon. Second, the researcher used the character and characterization theory to show the behavior of the main character towards nature to reestablish the ecology of Avalon. Lanjut, Pak. Chapter 4 is finding and discussion. Lanjut, Pak. For findings, I will explain some of my findings. First is about relationship between human and environment. I will explain about findings in pastoral, which is taken from the narration of the novel. The narration is, the stream flowed the past the camp and over the bluff above Miskatonic River, the greatest body of running water on the island. This narration indicates ecocriticism, which is pastoral, that emphasizes the relationship between human and agriculture activity and natural landscape. Next data is about wilderness, which is taken from narration. The narration is, the colonist has chosen a beautiful place to start a new world, lovely enough to make him feel almost at peace. This narration shows the concept of wilderness, which is explained the environment that uncontaminated by any human civilization and activity. The next data is animal, which is taken from dialogue. The dialogue is, Sylvia said, and look again, we've ruined the ecology is what we've done. First, we introduced new food sources. We weren't finding many catfish now. Then we killed all the adults. Mama hasn't been around to eat some lot. This dialogue shows the concept of animal, which explains the main cause of animal extinction is overhunting activity by humans. The extinction of wild animal has been affecting the ecology of Avalon. Lanjut, Pak. Next is the data about main character's behavior towards nature to reestablish the ecology of Avalon. First data is taken from the dialogue. The data is, Jerry, you're in charge of the technical staff. Mary Ann, take him to the bluff. Sylvia goes too. You'll work on defense. Why your house? Someone demand. It's the most defensive place on the island. This dialogue shows the main character's behavior towards nature through speech. The dialogue shows the characterization through speech, which is conversation by the character. Catman, as the main character, told people to move to a safer place and stop building settlement on Grendel's habitat to reestablish the ecology. And the next data is 100 days had passed since the battle. Grendel had established territory and fought to keep them like Siamese fighting fish, one Grendel to a pool, but unlike the fish who fought only until one retreat, if one Grendel intruded on another territory, the result was one dead Grendel and one well fed. This narration shows the result of the main character behavior towards nature to re-establish the ecology of Avalon. Catman as the main character shows his behavior towards nature from each action, like controlling Grendel population and territory. Catman managed to re-establish Grendel food chain, population, and territory. Lanjut. Next is about discussion. And the researcher used pastoral concept of ecocriticism by Greg Gerard and found the data that shows the relation between human and land as a part of environment in Avalon. The data in findings show the agricultural activity by people on Avalon, such as farming and raising livestock. By using the concept of wilderness, the researcher has found data that shows people on Avalon have started a civilization by building their settlement and destroy Grendel's habitat. The data that the researcher found using the animal concept shows overhunting activity can affect the ecology of Avalon. The researcher used intrinsic element of novel, which are character and characterization. Catman's speech by telling people to stop building settlement and his action to controlling Grendel's population and territory managed to prevent more destruction to wild animals' habitat. and reducing the overpopulated Grendel to reestablish the ecology of Avalon. Next and the last chapter is chapter 5, which is conclusion and suggestion. And my conclusion of this research is, first, the researcher conclude that the ecocreation theory can be seen from the legacy of Europe novel through the relationship between human and environment, such as overhunting towards wild animal and land consumption for building human settlement. Next conclusion is the legacy of Europe novel shows the negative relationship between human and environment, which caused the destruction of ecology on Avalon. Catman as the main character tries to make a positive relationship to reestablish the ecology of Avalon. The relationship can be seen from his speech, such as telling other people to stop building human settlement and overhunting activity. The relationship is also shown from his actions, such as killing some Grendel using an electric fence and deadfall trap. And the suggestion for this research, the researcher only focus on the legacy of Europe novel by Larry Niven, Jerry Pornell, and Stephen Barnes. The researcher only focus on pastoral, wilderness, and animal to analyze the relationship between humans and environment. Moreover, the researcher only use character and characterization to analyze the behavior of the main character towards nature. Hopefully, other researcher can use more intrinsic element in a novel and another ecocriticism concept by Greg Garrett to analyze the legacy of Europe novel or other literary works in future research. And that's it my presentation. Thank you. Saya kembalikan ke moderator.
Oke, terima kasih Mas Theo yang sudah memaparkan materinya, yang sudah memaparkan hasil penelitiannya. Selanjutnya, saya membuka sesi tanya-jawab. Sebentar, saya stop share dulu. Baik, selanjutnya saya membuka sesi tanya-jawab untuk ketiga presenter. Ada tadi Mas Anto, ada Theo, dan tadi ada Rizka. Baik, saya persilakan kepada bapak-bapak dan ibu-ibu yang sudah hadir di ruangan ini untuk berdiskusi. Saya persilakan. Mungkin bisa raise hand.
Saya Pengtra.
Mas Aris Utomo ya, dari Program Studi Sastra Inggris. Fakultas ya. Ilmu Budaya Universitas Mula Warman. Silakan Mas Aris.
Saya mau tanya dengan Mas Anto nih, Anto Rizaldi. Salam kenal ya Mas.
Gimana Mas? Saya kurang mendengar suaranya.
Oke, kedengaran enggak ini? Halo, tes?
Ya, siap. Oke. Jelas.
Ya, tanyaan buat Mas Anto Rizaldi. Salam kenal ya Mas.
Ya, salam Malang, kenal ya. Mas.
Malang. Dari Malang ya? Oh, Malang. Wah. Dari Singoedan
nih. Arema.
Oke. Okay. Arema. Ya, okay. Guys. Saya ingin tanya ini terkait sastra pinggiran ya. Ini wah, menarik juga nih, saya baru tahu ada sastra pinggiran gitu ya. Nah, terkait sastra pinggiran ini, selama Mas Anto melakukan penelitian ini, bagaimana tanggapan dari mereka, kelompok-kelompok yang Mas jadikan objek penelitian itu? Nah, yang kedua, apa sih indikator yang Mas gunakan sehingga kelompok-kelompok yang Mas sebutkan tadi itu menjadi objek dari kajian sastra pinggiran yang Mas lakukan? Terima kasih, Mas.
Ya, baik. Mungkin bisa langsung ditanggapi oleh Mas Anto.
Oke, baik. Terima kasih, Mas Aris. Saya manggil yang Mas saja lagi. Kalau Bapak, kelihatan tua nanti. Oke.
Ya, ketuaan.
Jadi gini Mas, Mas Aris, terkait indikator dulu ya, terkait indikator komunitas sastra pinggiran ya yang ada di Surabaya khususnya. Ini pertama karena memang saya itu cangkruknya, kalau orang Jawa bilang Surabaya itu cangkruk atau tempat kumpulnya itu di para sastrawan di beberapa komunitas Mas, dan mereka itu saya bilang itu curhat bahwa masa pandemi ini para sastrawan tidak bisa berkarya, tidak bisa menunjukkan biasanya kalau orang Surabaya manggung lah seperti itulah. Jadi sangat dibatasi Mas, biasanya di Cak Durasim dibuka untuk pertunjukan drama, teater dan sebagainya tutup selama 2 tahun. Kemudian kami teman-teman biasanya juga ngamen sastra di Taman Bungkul juga ditutup. Jadi indikator seperti inilah yang saya apa ya yang saya gunakan karena mereka itu gelisah gitu loh, nasib kami bagaimana gitu loh, sedangkan di karya-karya mereka itu sebenarnya itu bagus-bagus mas Adi, sangat banget bagus, jadi tidak kalah dengan para sastrawan yang sudah punya nama seperti itu. Dan indikator berikutnya adalah saya mengangkat sastra pinggiran ini karena saya ingin mengenalkan di masyarakat, di para peneliti, mahasiswa S2 maupun S3 maupun dosen-dosen sastra, bahwa sastra pinggiran itu ada dan komunitasnya itu ada gitu. Ini di Surabaya itu komunitas sastra pinggiran itu hanya sebagian kecil saja mas, dan yang menggerakkan itu ya anak mahasiswa, bukan orang, mohon maaf, bukan orang-orang dewasa, tapi masih muda-muda gitu loh. Dan mereka karya-karyanya, ide-idenya itu sangat luar biasa gitu loh, menghasilkan kalau bedah novel, bedah buku, dan mereka itu open. Jadi ketika ada yang mengkritiki karya mereka, ya mereka terima gitu loh, untuk kebaikan dirinya dan karya-karya berikutnya agar lebih bagus lagi, agar lebih bisa diterima lah, katakanlah seperti itu. Dan usulan ini mas, sastra pinggiran ini saya sampaikan ke pembimbing, dosen pengampu mata kuliah isu sastra mutakhir Indonesia, Prof. Wahyudi maupun Pak Taufik, dan beliau setuju gitu loh. Oke mas, lakukan penelitian, seperti itu. Dan saya melakukan penelitian ini agak was-was, karena apa, ada beberapa komunitas sastra di universitas itu tertutup. Jadi tidak berbeda ketika kalau dulu emang S1 saya di UNIPA dengan kerjasama dan komunitas Kopi Aksara, mereka welcome sekali karena memiliki hubungan lah seperti itu. Jadi dan berbeda ketika saya ke UNER, komunitas sastra di UNER maupun di UINSA. Jadi mereka itu apa tujuannya, mau apa, observasi, wawancara apa, dampaknya buat kami apa, seperti itu kan. Dan setelah saya menjelaskan bahwa tujuan saya mengangkat ini, saya mengenalkan, mereka akan lebih dikenal lah, tanda kutip seperti itu. Kemudian apa ya keluhan mereka apa, saya tampung, kemudian saya rangkum, saya tuliskan dalam artikel penelitian saya, seperti itu mas. Dan akhirnya ya overall semuanya welcome gitu. Jadi ketika saya tanya, ketika saya berkunjung, mereka menunjukkan beberapa dokumentasi, foto, maupun video, karena masa pandemi ini mas, para sastrawan itu agak susah gitu loh untuk mengapresiasikan karyanya, seperti itu mas Aris.
Gitu ya. Jadi memang permasalahannya sastrawan saat pandemi ini. Baik, ya. Terima kasih atas penjelasannya.
Sama-sama mas Aris.
Baik. Terima kasih untuk pertanyaan dari Mas Aris dan tanggapan dari Mas Anto. Saya kembali mengundang mungkin untuk satu penanya lagi. Silakan bagi yang ingin bertanya. Mas Alfian, saya melihat Mas Alfian raise hand. Monggo Mas Alfian.
Oke, terima kasih Pak Indra. Saya off cam nggak apa-apa ya, karena pelayaran juga sudah ada kan di situ. Oke.
Okay. Ya.
Nah, saya ingin ini Pak Indra mau bertanya ke yang tadi yang menganalisis puisinya Kori. Saya lupa tadi siapa ya.
Oh iya, Rizka.
Oke, okay, ya. Saya mau bertanya terkait puisi tadi yang sudah dianalisis itu kan. Tadi kalau nggak salah ingat saya mendengar bahwa puisi itu merupakan puisi anak ya, kalau nggak salah ya tadi ya, puisi anak. Tetapi tadi lebih fokus ke analisisnya berkaitan dengan eksploitasi hutan gitu ya, eksploitasi hutan. Nah, yang ingin saya tanyakan kira-kira kaitannya apa dengan penggunaan misalkan seperti metafora, penggunaan diksi yang digunakan oleh Kori ini untuk yang tadi ya, eksploitasi hutan dan lain-lain itu, kaitannya apa dengan tujuan Kori kira-kira untuk puisi ini? Jadi puisi ini kan tadi puisi anak gitu, jadi kaitannya apa itu dengan tujuan Kori menciptakan puisi anak ini?
Gitu. Baik, terima kasih Mas Alfian pertanyaannya. Bagaimana Rizka sudah bisa menangkap ya maksud dari pertanyaannya Mas Alfian, apa sih yang ingin disampaikan Kori melalui puisi-puisinya tersebut tentang eksploitasi hutan, kemudian penyebutan nama-nama tumbuhan, itu sebenarnya apa sih yang ingin dicapai gitu oleh Kori melalui karya tersebut? Monggo, Rizka.
Baik, terima kasih kepada Pak Alfian. Jadi yang pertama, puisi ini diciptakan pada tahun 2018 dan di buku tersebut merupakan kategori puisi anak. Sehingga kita ingin mengkaji lebih dalam apakah kumpulan puisi tersebut layak dibaca oleh anak-anak atau tidak. Berdasarkan penelitian dari tim kami, jadi Piget dan Kohlberg mengemukakan bahwa penilaian tingkah laku dalam kacamata anak kecil hanya dapat dibedakan dalam ke dalam baik dan buruk. Jadi tidak ada alternatif lain, tetapi pada usia anak yang kemudian terdapat kemampuan untuk mempertimbangkan lingkungan dan situasi yang membuat legitimasi adanya perbedaan pendapat. Jadi penjelasan ilmiah ini memberikan keterangan jika anak yang membaca puisi tersebut masuk dalam kategori usia anak tertentu yang hanya bisa membedakan baik dan buruk. Maka persepsi antara citraan dalam puisi Meranti Bunga dan lain-lain akan mengarah pada pemahaman bahwa mengekspresikan eksploitasi pohon atau hutan adalah hal yang benar. Sebab hal itu tercitra dalam puisi. Seperti itu Pak Alfian. Jadi hubungannya karena puisi tersebut menggunakan istilah-istilah ilmiah yang beberapa kategori anak itu tidak paham, maka puisi menurut dari tim kami ini tidak layak dikatakan puisi untuk anak, tetapi di atasnya, entah itu remaja atau dewasa, seperti itu.
Oke, baik, demikian tanggapan dari Rizka. Bagaimana Mas Alfian? Masih ada yang ingin ditanggapi?
Oke, ya, terima kasih Pak Indra. Oke, Rizka, jadi tadi intinya adalah menurut penelitian yang sudah dilakukan bahwa puisi ini sebenarnya tidak cocok gitu ya, tidak cocok dinikmati atau dikonsumsi oleh anak, begitu ya. Oh iya iya iya, ya, saya melihat Rizka bergerak, iya iya gitu. Oke, ya. Tapi mungkin lebih apa namanya? Jika memang masih sempat untuk di ini ya, dikulik atau ditelaah lebih jauh, mungkin bisa dilihat apa hubungannya gitu ya. Misalkan ketika jadi tidak hanya melihat puisi ini oke atau tidak gitu ya, baik atau tidak gitu ya menurut anak, tetapi dari penggunaan kata-kata yang digunakan, misalkan tadi ya eksploitasi hutan, kemudian misalkan ada kata membakar atau apa, apakah itu cocok atau tidak? Nah, itu yang mungkin perlu ditelaah lebih jauh ya, ditelaah lebih jauh sehingga bukan akhirnya akan melihat puisinya cocok atau tidak gitu ya untuk anak, tetapi tujuannya apa sih ketika puisi ini diciptakan dan dikategorikan sebagai puisi anak? Tujuannya untuk apa? Apakah untuk mengedukasi? Ya, jadi ada tujuan edukatifnya. Misalkan puisi ini diciptakan, oh agar anak tidak nantinya ketika dewasa itu tidak mengeksploitasi hutan, lebih cinta terhadap alam dan lain-lain. Apakah yang seperti itu atau bagaimana? Mungkin bisa sampai ke sana gitu ya?
Iya Pak. Okay. Ya benar, di puisi yang ditulis oleh Kori ini tentu ada pesan didaktis yang bersifat didaktis yang memberikan pengajaran, akan tetapi pembaca anak belum sampai kepada pemahaman tersebut. Seperti itu.
Oke, baik.
Terima kasih Pak atas sarannya, akan kami ulik-ulik lebih dalam lagi untuk penelitian selanjutnya. Terima kasih.
Ya, sama-sama.
Oke. Ya, baik, terima kasih kepada Mas Alfian dan kepada Rizka atas tanggapan ya dari pertanyaannya Mas Alfian. Baik, untuk sesi pertama saya rasa sudah cukup karena waktunya sudah pas di jam 2 siang waktu Indonesia Tengah. Baik, kita lanjut. Sekali lagi saya ucapkan terima kasih kepada semua presenter di sesi pertama dan kepada semua peserta yang aktif bertanya di sesi ini. Terima kasih banyak. Selanjutnya saya mengundang 3 presenter di sesi kedua. Saya bacakan dulu namanya sebentar. Di sesi kedua kali ini ada 3 presenter dari jurusan dari program studi sastra Inggris Fakultas Ilmu Budaya Universitas Mula Warman. Yang pertama adalah Manalu Yeriko Calvin. Yang akan presentasi kedua, presenter kedua adalah Fergi Eka Wahyu. Dan yang ketiga adalah Galih Anom. Sudah siap ya untuk menyajikan makalahnya, untuk membentangkan papernya. Saya persilakan kepada Manalu terlebih dahulu untuk menyajikan makalahnya. Ya, sudah terlihat ya. Oh iya. Halo, Manalu, silakan langsung dimulai saja sesi pemaparan presentasinya. Saya persilakan. Nah, suaranya tidak terdengar. Manalu, coba mungkin masih di unmute atau bagaimana? Coba di unmute dulu. Coba tes lagi. Wah, masih belum terdengar. Ini hanya di tempat saya atau bagaimana peserta yang lain bisa mendengar suaranya Calvin?
Tidak, Pak Indra. Tidak kedengaran.
Tidak ya? Iya, Calvin. Sepertinya audionya yang bermasalah. Coba diperbaiki dulu.
Handsfree-nya mungkin dilepas. Nggak usah pakai handsfree mungkin.
Iya, coba dilepas dulu. Handsfree-nya.
Tes.
Ya. Oke, silakan.
Ya, terima kasih untuk kesempatannya. And now I will begin my presentation entitled Analysis of the Relationship Between Human and Non-Humanistic Eco-Criticism in Gordon G. L. Ramil's Booms. Next part. This presentation consists of Chapter 1 Introduction, Chapter 2 Review of Related Literature, Chapter 3 Research Methods, Chapter 4 Findings and Discussion, Chapter 5 Conclusion and Suggestions. Lanjut. It begins with chapter 1 introduction, 1.1 background of research. Nature is very important because it provides resources for everything in the world. Human life depends on nature because most of the things they consume comes from it. Throughout history, humans have an intimate relationship with nature, most obviously depending on it for subsistence and production, also interactions for recreation and enjoyment. Daily states, the lack of awareness helps humans start to disrupt the systems. Dominant ecosystems and if awareness is not increased, will cause extinctions of native species and alter the ecosystem. In this research, the researcher chose the 3 set of poems that are written by Gordon Ramel. And this object content of the relationship between human and non-human and the domination by human toward non-human. Eco-criticism emphasizes place, nature, and the physical world that seeks to demonstrate humanity's interconnected to all these living organisms and their physical environment. In this research, the researcher chose eco-criticism theory to find out the relationship between human and non-human and how is the representation of nature inside the booms. Next part. here are researchers' considerations. This theory will help researcher to see the deeper case of ecology that has an important role in literary work. Mankind or humans was to try to dominate or ruin the non-human or nature because of their interest. And the researcher has read Rimmel's poems, and the poems that are selected by the researcher contains the gap or imbalance relationship between human, non-human, and representation of nature. Next. 1.2, research questions. Based on the illustration of the background, the researcher formulates two kinds of research questions as below. One, how is the relationship between human and non-human in such three recited poems? Two, how is nature represented in three recited poems? 1.3, purposes of the research. Based on research questions, the purposes of the research are, one, to find out the relationship between human and non-human in such three recited poems. Two, to find out the representation of nature in three recited poems. 1.4, significance of the research. The significance of this research is mainly focused on academic aspect. One, to give a contribution to acknowledge the cognizant theory that portrayed in the poems. Two, the last is hopefully the result of this research is can be reference for those who want to analyze another poem which has ecology principles. 1.5, research limitations. The researcher will focus on three recited poems by Gordon Joel Rimmel and using ecocriticism concepts by Greg Garrard to analyze the relationship between human and non-human and representation of nature in three recited poems. Next. 1.6, definition of key terms. The researcher makes some key of terms that represent the contents of this research. Here is the key of terms that is given by the researcher. One, ecocriticism. Ecocriticism is the study of the relationship between literature and the physical environment. Two, nature. Is that thing over there, somewhere that we choose to go to, something that we can either take part in or avoid as we choose. Three, animals are the objects of our ever-extending knowledge. Next. 2, review of related literature. 2.1, poem. A poem is the arrangement of words that contain meaning and musical elements. It is a piece of writing that expresses the writer's thought and feelings in order to set a mood. It can be happy or sad, simple or complex. There are idiosyncratic features to distinguish poem to other literary works. 2.1.1, verse, stichic verse. The stichic verse is called stanzas of uneven length or verse paragraphs. It can be seen in a poem that is composed as continuous sequence of lines without any division of those lines into regular stanzas. 2.1.2, stanza. Four-line forms are usually known as quatrains and reckoned to be the most common verse form in European poetry. 5, 6, 7-line stanzas, and in many respects, their effects will be similar to those of the quatrain. Next. 2.1.3, diction. Diction is one of the elements of a poem that uses the words in oral or works. 2.1.4, imagery. Imagery is one of the elements of a poem that has a great variety of meanings. There are two types of imagery that are used by the researcher. The first, visual imagery, is the kind of imagery that represents a mental picture, something seen in the mind's eye. Two, auditory imagery is the kind of imagery that represents sound. 2.1.5, figurative language. Rhetorical figures or figure of speech is one of the stylistic features in poem. One, simile, is a comparison between two different things which are connected by like, then, as, or compare. Two, personification, is a comparison of something abstract to a human being that gives something non-human the characteristics of human being. Next. 2.1.6, the theme is one of the elements of a poem that indicates the central idea of literary works. 2.2, ecocriticism. Gard's great work entitled Ecocriticism, the New Critical Idiom. In his book, Gard explains the concepts that have most occupied ecocritics, including pollution, positions, pastoral, wilderness, apocalypse, dwelling, animals, and the earth. There are two types of concepts that are used by the researcher. The first is animals. The study of the relation between animals and humans in the humanities is split between philosophical consideration of animal rights and cultural analysis of the representation of animals. Two, pastoral. Pastoral ecology models width of harmony and balance. Next. 2.3, preview studies. Here are some of preview studies. The first, Journal of Humanities and Social Science, Gordon Joel Rimmel's Mankind Doesn't Agree on Ecocritical Interpretation. Two, Journal of Research in Humanities and Social Science, Concept of Ecocriticism in T.S. Eliot's Poetry. Three, Journal of Literature, Languages and Linguistics, Wordsworth the Prelude, A Manifesto of Ethical Criticism. Next. Chapter 3, Research Method. 3.1 Research Design. Qualitative method is the process of exploring and understanding the problem experienced by human being that occur in natural settings. This research uses qualitative method and the data that is analyzed by the researcher in the forms of words or sentences. 3.2 Data and source of data. The main sources for this research are the poems by Gardner Ramos entitled Mankind Doesn't Agree, Tiger Tiger Revisited, and Daffodils No More. The researcher analyzed it from the criteria such as verse and stanza, which shows the relationship between human and non-human. Also, diction, imagery, figurative language, and theme, which shows the representation of nature in three related poems. 3.3 Data collection. According to Creswell, data collection is about the role of the researcher set the stage for discussion of issues in collecting data. The researcher will use several steps to collect data that need to be analyzed. The first, the researcher reads the whole poems. Two, the researcher focuses on ethical criticism theory and elements of poems. Three, the researcher ensures that the ethical criticism theory and elements of poem are relevant to analyze the poems. 3.4, data analysis. By using the principles and practices of textual analysis espoused by ethical criticism, ethical critics concerning nature, humanity, and the environment. Next. Chapter 4, Findings and Discussion. 4.1, Findings. The researcher collects the data from verse and stanza in each poem. The researcher explains the verse and stanza that shows the relationship between human and non-human and explains the diction, imagery, figurative language, and theme that shows the representation of nature inside the poems. Moreover, the researcher used the concept of animals and pastoral to show that the concepts are relevant to analyze the data. 4.1.1, relationship between human and non-human and the representation of nature in Mankind Doesn't Agree poem. Here's the example. I have no use for birds in cages, but Mankind Doesn't Agree. They have been gulling them for ages, and they didn't seem to see that the beauty that inspires inevitably fades, and what once was read in diamonds will in time be played in space. The first is about the poet who doesn't use cages for birds, but Mankind care about that and still use cages for birds. They do not notice that cages make the beauty of the birds fade. The diction of the lines can be seen by word gulling, which proves how nature or birds are being imprisoned in a cage by Mankind. The imagery can be seen by the word inevitably fades, which represents the poet's visual sensor and shows the beauty of nature or birds has faded because of Mankind. The figurative language of personification can be seen by the sentence, the beauty that inspired, which represents the beauty of the birds as if inspired humans with their beauty of themselves that makes humans want to possess birds. The theme of the poem can be determined as human greed based on the diction by the word galling, the imagery by the word inevitable fates, and the figurative language of personification by the sentence, the beauty that inspires the concrete idea in the poem. The concept of animals emphasizes that humans should not have a position toward non-human because of interest. It is clearly beyond the boundary of the relationship because Mankind is arbitrary. Mankind use cages for birds, then cast them in prison. The concept of pastoral emphasizes that nature or birds has to be balanced. It means Mankind has to treat birds well, not to use cages. Next, 4.1.2, relationship between human and non-human and representation of nature in Tiger Tiger Revisited poem. Here's the example. What the learning, what the thought, that values lives like yours at naught, what the science or machines, where beauty such as yours is seen. The stanza is about humankind who cannot use their intelligence wisely toward tiger. The technology has been improved over the years by humans, although the beauty of tiger cannot be compared to science or machine that had taken a role in the development of human race. The figurative language of simile can be seen by the sentence that values lives like yours at naught, that represents the comparison between the learning and the thought of humankind that makes them think to do poaching towards tiger. And the sentence where beauty such as yours is seen, that represents the comparison between the science or machine and the tigers, the beauty of the tigers is a majestic and cannot be compared to anything else. The theme of the poem can be determined as human greed based on the figurative language of simile by sentence that values lives like yours at naught, and where beauty such as yours is seen as the concrete idea in the poem. Next, 4.1.3, relationship between human and non-human and representation of nature in the evolution of morphome. Here's the example, for butterflies, for birds I saw, for all of nature's finest games that I had long ago been taught, be that the Venus and the Thames, cares our valleys, bless our moors, and dance by thousands on our shores. Next. Four point two discussion. The relationship between human and non-human can be seen through the first and stanza of each poem. Moreover, the representation of nature that can be seen through the diction, imagery, figurative language, and theme of each poem. It can be concluded that the relationship between human and non-human is relevant, which can be seen by the way how humans treat birds, tigers, and daffodils inside the poems. Humans treat them badly, like they use cages for birds because they want to possess the birds. They kill the tigers to get advantages from selling the bones and replace the daffodils and build their territory as civilization of humans. This relevant relationship represents nature feel desperate, although it deserves the same rights to have a good life from humans. Humans should not let it feel the pain, and its existence should not be disrupted because of human societies. The novelty of this research are the objects of the research, the theory of ecofascism by Garth Gregg, and intrinsic elements of poem or poetic language. Next. Chapter 5, Conclusion and Suggestions. 5.1 Conclusion. The researcher concludes that the poems and theory are relevant to be analyzed. The researcher analyzed the poems and proved that the poems illustrate that the relationship between human and non-human is relevant, and it represents how nature affected by them. 5.2 Suggestions. The next researcher used ecofascism that is proposed by Greg Gard to analyze a poem that has same discussion. Hopefully, this research can be a reference and useful for other researchers to get a deep understanding about ecofascism theory and the concept of ecofascism by Greg Gard. Okay, that's all my presentation. Thank you.
Okay, terima kasih. Manalu,
yeah.
Kelvin ya, yang sudah menyajikan papernya. Baik, untuk selanjutnya saya persilahkan kepada Fergi Eka Wahyu untuk menyajikan presentasinya. Bisa share screen sendiri ya? Ya. Fergi ya? Oke, ternyata bisa. Baik, silakan Fergi, saya persilahkan untuk mempresentasikan penelitiannya.
Bisa dengar saya?
Cek, oke, cek. Masuk, masuk. 2, 3.
Aduh, ini kok error ini. Bentar. Ah, ini dia. Oh. Macet-macet ya. Mohon maaf ya sebentar ya. Nah. Ya, bisa dilihat ya?
Ya, silakan.
Oke, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you for having me in this seminar, and this is my research that conduct with my lecturers, Mr. Nasrullah and Jonathan Iren Saptika Dewi Max, entitled Gender Struggle of Mind Character in Edith Wharton, The House of Myth Novel. Let's begin. This is the abstract version of my research. This is the English version, and this is the Indonesian version. An introduction, theoretical background. There's four theoretical background in my research, and the first one is said from book from according to Peter Barry, is that the female has been the object of weak and fragile and become the reflection of self and beauty, fairness and kindness. And therefore, in the 19th century, created a movement called feminism. Female also have been the object of many literary works, such as both in social structure or political, more informed novels, short story, and others. Men and women have different challenges in social life. In this case, women have more difficulties because of their gender identities. And because of that, gender struggle was born because a woman wanted their existence to be more influenced both in their life and also in social structure. In a novel of House of Myth, it's clearly understood that the struggle of main character represents their direction, their desires and ambition that are difficult to achieve because of their gender identity. Actually, in this novel, it's focusing about the protagonist of the novel, which is Lily Bard. And this study is focusing on finding data related to gender struggle carried out by main character in the novel by focusing the problem. Sorry, actually she faces from the struggle and also can be seen on character development. Related literature, there's three understanding of gender struggle from Paddy McQueen. The first one is that gender struggle of a woman is not only for social purpose, but also for to make themselves more comfortable and proud to their action. Although it is difficult because gain recognition from opposite gender, which is men. But the second one is that every struggle that is carried by woman or by woman is that important because there will always no certain result that that struggle will gain, will get a better result or worse result. The focus of gender struggle in literature is to look of any woman effort that has impression in social relation over gender, especially men. There are four types of gender struggle in this research. The first one is struggle of love. Struggle of love is cannot be measured by any means, but and can only be measured by promise. And this promise must be realized to achieve true love. The struggle of love for women is far more harder because it's required strong judgment, decision, and promise. And that's why this struggle is harder for women because their action and feeling can be manipulated and exploited by men. A struggle of dream. According to Bryson, that woman cannot achieve their dream or their desire or their goal because of gender inequality. And that's why the gender struggle of a dream is to lock any effort of women that have want to desire to their specific goals or ambition. Because women can only be understanding as men supporter. And this is why male supremacy and economic factors is the most major obstacle to women's desire to be respected. The struggle of fact of life is more closely related to physical needs, such as how that woman is going to have what she wanted with only his capabilities and limitation. So her capability or her ability is the only way or other's capability is going to make her become a better person in the future or gain her success or not. But and also the limitation is also the one who make her or she going to become have more struggle or not. The affection, struggle affection is according to Dillow is directly closely related to struggle of love, which is can be said that the struggle of affection is can be said as the first action to express how love is gained. And this struggle is interpreted as a form of communication toward closeness, care, and fondness for another. Character development. There's two understanding of character development. The first one is according to Berg, there are three character development, which is three phases. The first phase is character recognition, how the character is introduced in the story by her or he characteristic. And the second phase is about character problem that entering the conflict, either getting better or worse. And the third phase or the final phase is the outcome that changed the nature of the character himself. Whelan also supports this that each character development have different arcs. And these arcs have positive, flat, and negative. Even though there's positive, flat, and negative arc, there always still be three different phase in positive arc, flat arc, or negative arc. Character research method. In this research, is focusing on using qualitative research by closely related to the novel of The House of Myth from Edith Morehouten that have relationship between the theory, which is the gender struggle and character development. And the data in this research is contents with writing, words, phrases, sentences, and paragraph, both dialogue and narration. At finding and discussion, the first finding and discussion is from struggle of dream. In this quotation, is focusing that Lily one something that men always have. Lily thinks that she is miserable because of she as a woman cannot have something that her friend, which is Sheldon Lawrence, is a male character that loves Lily, thinking that Lily Lily as inferior as men because men always have something that a woman doesn't have. The second struggle is that fact of life in this quotation is that Lily thinking that Sheldon, even though she is shabby clothes or maybe have a dirty clothes, there's no one scared about him and always asking about that Sheldon maybe can be have a friend even though she's dirty or maybe shabby in her clothes, but as a woman, the clothes as the background, the friend. And that's what makes success to Lily. Lily thinking that Lily's opinion is that the differences between men and women cannot be said as fair because men can do whatever they want as long as there are nothing problem with their appearance. But woman, the clothes is the background. Her appearance is the background to make a success. Finding and discussion from a struggle of affection in this quotation is that Lily is wishing to meet Sheldon in the cold night. She can be said as waiting Sheldon for a long time as to make attention to Sheldon. Sheldon thinking that Lily doesn't love him. Sheldon thinking that she doesn't love him, Sheldon. That's why Sheldon doesn't mind making Lily wait for too long. But Lily thinking that for him never coming because she thinking that Sheldon is the only person that can Lily give attention to because Sheldon is the only person that so close to Lily and her struggle. Struggle of love in this quotation is focusing that Lily is a person that have such a lack of common sense. So because she thinking that Sheldon is not worthy for Lily because even though Sheldon is successful lawyers, see, Lily always thinking that it's stupid to love someone if you doesn't have luxuries or expensive things or wealthy because that is what makes someone happy. And without that, you cannot be happy and there's no love. But Lily struggled to understand what is love because Sheldon is the person that understands Lily's struggle and situation. Sheldon tried to love her is only to want to save Lily from her extravagance or luxurious desires. It's character development, analysis, and finding and discussion. The first character development is from struggle of affection. In this quotation is that Lily is thinking that she wants an attention to someone that close to him. She wants someone that can be said as a best friend or a close friend that can give her secret to others to understand her situation. She wants to be success. She wants to be success to become a woman that have a successful in the young life. That's why she tried to give attention to Sheldon that she the introduction of this quotation from Lily Bart is that she thinking that she can have such attention to Sheldon and thinking that Sheldon can give him suggestion or something like for the best for Lily future. And slowly the character development from affection, Lily understand that she always have attention from Sheldon, but she never understand Sheldon because Sheldon only love her, but Sheldon always love her to become a person that always want to help Lily, but Lily never know about that because Lily can be said as lack of common sense. The character development of fact of life in this quotation that Lily opinion that men is have a better understanding of woman motives rather than woman because Lily thinking that her struggle, her action that to become a success by becoming a businesswoman and also working with other wealthy people, thinking that she doesn't have any motives that better can do. She only thinking that as a woman, she doesn't understand what she doing, either to have a good side or not negative side. But Sheldon, as a man, Lily thinking that everything that men do is have a better motive than woman. But slowly, her character is developed to understand that every man in this environment, in her environment, always have something that want to gain from her. That's why she understands who she trusts and who she's not, cannot be trust. Character development of from dream. This character development of dream is from the last phase of second phase, which is she is her struggle is becoming a downfall. She becoming a person that have so much debt to other people. Her friends, her close friend is stay away from her because she is becoming poor because someone is manipulated her to do their biddings. And then Lily becoming something can be called as miserable woman. She's become paranoid. She's thinking that her downfall is soon, and she's thinking that maybe the horror is will be going become someone like her, as a beautiful like her, is becoming a person that doesn't have anything. In the first story and in the beginning, Lily is have a house, she is wealthy, and right now she has been manipulated by other characters, and she is becoming poor because she is in debt to other person, and she has been manipulated by other characters, which is by other characters such as other male characters. Character development of love. In this character development is the first phase actually, because this character development is also have similarity with struggle of love, because Lily doesn't have any common lack of common sense, because she thinking that it's stupid to love someone if you doesn't have happiness, and happiness can be all achieved by material, and material can be achieved by wealthiness. And Lily thinking that Sheldon is not worthy to love him is because she understand in the ending, the last chapter, that Sheldon is want to help her to out from her miserable life and to become a wife that understand about simplicity. But Lily doesn't know that, and she is succumbed to paranoid because of she has been in debt to other, and her all of her wealthiness is gone because she has been manipulated by other characters. Discussion, there's the discussion in this research. The first one is discovered that the gender struggle that Lily Bart experienced as a younger in the struggle of love. There's four gender struggle: love, dream, fact of flame, and affection. There's other characters that support this struggle, such as Sheldon, Rosdale, and Gertie Farish. Based on the findings, the struggle have the significant and the most frequent is fact of life and love. And furthermore, the character development that have the most influential data that present is fact of life, affection, and dream. Conclusion. In the conclusion, after analyzing that is gender struggle shown by main female character in Lily Bart in the Edith Wharton story by using feminism theory, is that the gender struggle and the evidence of character development is presented in the story and demonstrated by the struggle of dream, affection, love, and fact of life. Furthermore, this research also found that the development of Lily Bart character has influenced by several actions she took, her struggle for dream, love, affection, and fact of life. And that is my presentation. This is the work cited. And thank you very much for the time has been given. Back to the moderator.
Ya, terima kasih untuk Fergie. Baik, untuk pemateri selanjutnya saya persilahkan kepada Galih Anom. Galih Anom sudah siap ya?
Siap.
Oke, ya silakan Galih Anom bisa share screen.
Baik.
Coba tes dulu. Oke, kembali saya ingatkan waktu presentasi berkisar 10 sampai 15 menit ya. Harap diperhatikan lagi waktunya. Oke, masih belum terlihat di layar saya. Masih proses. Oke, sudah. Oke. Ya, sudah tampak. Oke, langsung saja kepada Gali untuk memaparkan bahan tayangnya, silakan.
Tes. Halo, tes. Apakah suara saya jelas?
Ya. Jelas-jelas Gali, silakan.
Oh iya. Oke, saya mulai ya. Maaf. Oke. Thank you for the opportunity. In this opportunity, I will present my thesis entitled Prejudice Towards African American Characters in Mildred D. Taylor's The Road to Memphis novel. To begin with, I will start with the history of marginalized groups of African Americans who are known to experience and suffer unfair treatments in the past of United States. As Tyson recounts, the extreme forms of overt violence against African Americans seems to be a thing of the past in the United States. The overt violence includes lynching, assassination of Black leaders, bombing of Black churches, and treating brutally against civil rights protesters. Now, these mistreatments towards other groups are the result of intense ethnic prejudice. As Alport says, the prejudicial attitude may induce various forms of antipathetic conduct, such as talking against people, discriminating, and even attacking them with violence. The phenomenon of prejudice is not only happened in real life, but also portrayed in literary work. One of the literary work is The Road to Memphis novel, written by African-American novelist Mildred D. Taylor in 1990. The novel story is about a group of African-American teenagers who have to protect and save one of their fellow friends named Mo Turner from lynching. In order to protect their friends, they need to get Mo to Chicago. However, their journey is marked with a number of discrimination and humiliation and even persecution. Therefore, the writer chose this novel because it portrays a strong issue of ethnic prejudice against African Americans. And this study focused on investigating prejudice against African American characters in The Road to Memphis novel. There are two objectives of this study. The first, to identify the forms of prejudice. Second, to analyze how African American characters respond to prejudice. In order to achieve the objectives, the writer used theories of Gordon Alport. The first is acting out prejudice. The second one is a traits of prejudice victimization theory. Based on the background, the writer formulated two research questions. The first is, what are the forms of prejudice towards African Americans? Second, how are the African American characters respond to prejudice? And the significance of this research, theoretically, This study is expected to be a reference for future researchers who wish to raise the same topic of prejudice. Practically, the finding of this study may be used as data, a study material in relevant academic course. Next, we move to the theories used in this study. The first theory is prejudice. What is prejudice? In simple, prejudice is a negative presumption towards a group. When a person has this negative presumption, it most likely to affect their attitude as well as their actions. And this is accordance with what Alport says, that prejudicial attitude tends somehow somewhere to express itself in hostile actions. Gordon Alport offers 5 types of hostile action. The first one is interlocution. It is an act of talking against people, include gossips, derisive joke, and name calling with such epithet like nigger. And then avoidance, the act of avoiding someone due to their racial group. The third is discrimination, is the act of denying equal treatment. Fourth is physical attack, is an act of violence. And the last is extermination, is ultimate degree of violent expression of prejudice, which include lynching, pogroms, and massacres. The second theory is traits of prejudice victimization. This theory, traits of prejudice victimization, is the traits developed by the victim of prejudice. There are 14 types of traits, but Alport categorized them into 2 categories. The first is extropositive. These are the traits that are essentially aggressive, outgoing, and indicating attack. And the second category is intropositive, where the victim tends to take responsibility upon himself for adjusting the situations. Next, we move to the research method of this study. The research design in this study is qualitative, while the approach is descriptive. Data in the study are the texts which indicate hostile actions and traits of prejudice victimization. Meanwhile, data source in the study are primary data which only be obtained from the Road to Memphis novel. Next is collecting data and analyzing data. The technique of collecting data in the studies used close reading method, which include 3 steps of collecting data. The first is reading the novel several times. Second, focus on observing the words which indicate prejudice. Third, take note of words that have potential to be used as data. And for the technique of analyzing data, this study used Miles and Haberman's model of qualitative data analysis. The 3 steps of collecting data is data reduction. It will be sorting out the previously collected data and classifying data according to the defined type. Second, data display. The classified data were displayed through an organized table. And the last stage is conclusion. It will conduct a deep analysis of each data based on the criteria of Gordon Alport's prejudice theory. A deep analysis carried out at this stage was crucial because it will serve as validation of the data. The next is the findings of this study. The first one is interlocution. It is portrayed when a young white man named Statler Arms encounters Clarence, who is an African-American. In their encounter, the white man tried to make fuss and spoke disrespectfully to Clarence. In this quotation, the act of interlocution can be identified when the white man calls Clarence with epithet nigger, along with hostile attitude. In addition, Statler's hostility is shown in the way he spoke disrespectfully and unfriendly towards Clarence. The next one is discrimination. It is portrayed when Stacy and his fellow African-Americans need to take Clarence to the hospital. However, the hospital rejects to treat African-Americans. It is evident in the following quotation. It is put in this quotation, discrimination towards African Americans is portrayed in the dialogue when a nurse tells them that they do not treat Negroes in their hospital. This hospital policy of not serving medical care for African Americans is an example of racial segregation. Next is physical attack. It is portrayed when Casey was caught by a grown white man for sneaking in the white restroom. In this scene, the attendant threatens to call the police, and even worse, he assaults Casey by kicking her like a dog. It is evident in the following quotation. In this quotation, the physical attack is shown by the act of violence perpetrated by a grown white man against African-American girl, Cassie. It was evident in the quotation, the attendant squashed and the purse under his foot, then he kicked at me with his other foot, like somebody with no heart will kick a dog. And the next is obsessive concern and suspicion. It is portrayed when Casey and little man, who were African-Americans, were hesitant to go into the store because they saw a bunch of white men were gathering and laughing inside the store. In this quotation, obsessive concern is shown when little man said, maybe we best not go in, not with Statler and Dom in there anyway. This shows that little man was hesitant to go in due to white people. Little man's hesitation indicates that he was worried or insecure about possible humiliation he would get if he goes into the store. The last findings is strengthening in group ties. This trait is represented throughout the whole story in a group of several African-American characters. They develop special solidarity to protect one of their fellow friends, Nemo Turner, from lynching. In this quotation, strengthening in group ties is shown when Stacy and other African-American characters offer to drive Mo Turner to the station so that they can get away from the police. Besides, the solidarity and cleanliness of these several African-American characters is portrayed throughout the story where they always protect each other from mistreatment. The next session is discussion of the findings. Well, if it is compared to previous study, there are several previous findings that are similar to this study as follow. Antilocution described in Rahma's study was similar to this study where both found insulting remark. Discrimination described in Maurice's study also shared similarity to this study where both found segregation toward marginalized group of African Americans. While physical attack described in Maurice's study, the similarity lied in the physical threat and against African American characters. And the victimization traits of withdrawal and passivity and aggression and revolt are also found in Rahma's study. Meanwhile, the novelty of this study found two other types of victimization, which are not found in any other previous finding. These traits are obsessive concern and strengthening in group ties. The last slide is conclusion. Based on the finding, there are three forms of prejudice against African Americans, namely antilocution, discrimination, and physical attack. And then the finding also finds four traits of prejudice victimization represented in African American characters, namely obsessive concern, withdrawal and passivity, aggression and revolt, and the last is threatening and group ties. And the last is African-American response to prejudice are represented in four ways, namely through the character speech, action, reaction, and thoughts. And in the most part, they are portrayed through the character speech or dialogue. That's all from my presentation. Terima kasih. Saya kembalikan ke moderator.
Ya, oke. Okay. Terima kasih untuk Gali atas pemaparan presentasinya, pemaparan materinya. Baik, selanjutnya saya persilakan kepada peserta yang lain untuk bertanya ataupun memberikan masukan dan saran terkait penelitian yang akan dilakukan atau yang sudah dilakukan oleh ketiga presenter tadi. Silakan, mungkin ada yang ingin menanggapi diskusi sesi kedua ini. silakan. Karena ini kebanyakan yang hadir di room ini kebanyakan teman-temannya sendiri mungkin ya. Karena hampir semua yang presentasi di room 6 ini mahasiswa sastra Inggris ya, betul ya? Hanya ada tadi beberapa peserta dari luar. Jadi silakan kepada mungkin teman-temannya sendiri yang ingin memberikan tanggapan, saran, ataupun bertanya kepada tiga presenter tadi, dipersilakan. Masih ada waktu sekitar 10 menit lagi sebelum kita masuk ke sesi ketiga, sesi terakhir. Bagaimana, ada? Oke, kalau misalkan belum ada pertanyaan, mungkin bisa langsung kita lanjut saja ya ke sesi tiga untuk mengefektifkan waktu. Silakan. Oh, ada. Siapa itu? Fergi. Gimana, jadi, Fergi?
Untuk sebenarnya sih, untuk teman saya juga sih, Galih. Karena kebetulan saya kemarin mungkin tidak hadir karena untuk presentasinya yang bersangkutan, Galih. Tapi sebenarnya saya ingin bertanya untuk Galih.
Silakan.
Galih, ya ini sebenarnya cuma opini aja sih. Saya cuma minta opininya Galih karena karena kita mungkin berdua ini kan kayak saya feminisme itu dan Galih itu prejudice atau sudut pandang bisa dibilang itu benar-benar situasi yang ibaratnya dibilang sensitif. Tapi kalau saya cuma minta opininya Galih aja sih. Dari antara lima yang findings discussion-nya ada lima ya?
Iya, lima bentuk prasangka. Iya, ada lima.
Ya, ada lima itu menurut Galih itu untuk saat ini aja, untuk saat kita ini di tahun ini atau mungkin di saat-saat seperti ini, yang mana yang menurut Galih itu yang paling paling sering terjadi atau mungkin ya bisa yang paling sering terjadi kalau begitu bisa dibilang. Opininya saja saya minta sebenarnya. Jadi enggak apa-apa kalau mau dijawab bahasa Inggris, boleh, it's okay, no problem, but if you think that Indonesian is better to explain it, it's okay. Yeah, because I only just asking about the opinion.
Iya, saya paham. Yeah, langsung saya jawab ya. Jadi yang paling sering terjadi dari kelima bentuk prasangka, kan ada lima ya, ada antilokusi, diskriminasi, physical attack, avoidance, sama extermination. Di Indonesia sendiri yang sejauh ini yang saya perhatikan dan saya amati, observasi juga, tidak hanya di lingkungan kampus, bahkan di masyarakat, di sekitar circle saya, salah satu yang paling sering adalah bentuk antilokusi. Antilokusi tadi itu adalah berbicara against people. Bahasa Indonesianya mungkin agak sedikit aneh, yaitu berbicara melawan orang. Seperti kita mengata-ngatai seseorang. Gitu. Itu salah satu bentuk prasangka yang paling sering saya temukan, baik di circle saya, bahkan di kampus juga sama. Gitu. Bentuknya itu sebenarnya nggak harmful gitu, nggak berbahaya gitu. Seperti misalkan gosip, kita menggosipi seseorang appearance mereka atau dari mana mereka berasal, atau misalkan saya menggosipi ada salah satu mahasiswa dari region lain, misalkan contoh Papua, oh mahasiswa itu stinky ya, bau ya maksudnya, atau hal semacam itu. Nah ini udah masuk ke ranah prejudis gitu. Dan gosip, terus candaan yang bersifat mengejek dan berkaitan dengan ras mereka, itu juga sering saya temukan. Kemudian insult, kalau insult kayaknya di real life itu jarang ya, tapi saya sering melihat insult terhadap suatu ras itu sering saya lihat di sosial media. Saya sering lihat di komen-komen di YouTube, di Instagram, insulting towards or against other people, other group, itu tuh sangat sering terjadi. Ya saya rasa antilokusi paling sering ditemukan di Indonesia khususnya. So, ya, terima kasih.
Ya, terima kasih Galih. Sebenarnya sih kalau bisa dibilang itu juga benar sekali ya, karena siapa sih di bahkan kita nggak usah jauh-jauh lah, kita bilang di kampus aja mungkin bisa banyak yang gosipin kita mungkin ya kan. Nah, itu jadi beranggapan itu benar-benar yang udah saya bilang, kenapa saya tanyakan ini karena yang kebetulan yang Galih sampaikan itu prejudice itu benar-benar luar biasa sangat sulit ditemukan kebenarannya, yang paling benar yang mana, dan merasa yang paling benar itu juga salah, maka dari itu saya meminta opininya Galih. Dan ya jelas Galih juga memberikan contoh yang solid, dan kita nggak usah jauh-jauh ya kayak Galih tadi sampai ke ini, dan ternyata Galih bisa memberikan pemahamannya lewat yang ada di kampus, teman-teman sekampus, walaupun kita bisa dengan teman sekampus itu pun bisa terjadi sedikit prejudice di situ, walaupun yang dikatakan Galih sangat benar, tidak kasar, tapi tetap itu prejudice dan kita tidak bisa menyepelekannya. Sekali lagi terima kasih Galih dan mohon maaf merepotkan, tapi terima kasih wawasannya. Semoga kedepannya sukses. Amin. Terima kasih.
Amin. Sama-sama, Fer.
Oke. Ya, terima kasih kepada Fergie ya yang sudah menanggapi, dan Galih yang sudah menjawab tanggapan tersebut. Nah, inilah pentingnya kita bertukar pikiran saat melakukan conference seperti ini ya. Jadi ini penting ya untuk bertukar pikiran dan nanti memperkaya wawasan, memperkaya insight dari tulisan yang akan kalian lakukan ke depannya. Jadi ini sebenarnya pentingnya bertukar wawasan. Jadi Fergie tidak harus meminta maaf karena telah merepotkan Anom ya. Jadi harusnya Anom berterima kasih karena sudah mendapatkan kesempatan untuk ditanggapi. Seperti itu harusnya. Baik, dengan demikian maka berakhir pula sesi kedua ini. Terima kasih kepada para pembicara di sesi kedua. Sekali lagi saya sebutkan tadi ada Manalo Kelvin, ada Fergie Eka, ada Galih Anom yang sudah mempresentasikan penelitian mereka. Baik, langsung saja saya panggil kepada tiga presenter terakhir, masih dari Prodi Sastra Inggris, Fakultas Ilmu Budaya Universitas Mula Warman. Mungkin bisa langsung share screen saja ya. Bisa langsung share screen saja supaya kalian bisa mengatur sendiri kenyamanan kalian berpresentasi. Langsung saja saya panggilkan yang pertama ada Meliana Francisca Dora, yang kedua ada Merlin Oktaviani Ruwata, yang ketiga ada Saskia Magfira Wajdi. Untuk kesempatan pertama saya persilakan kepada Meliana Francisca. Siap Meliana, coba dites dulu share screen-nya. Nah, sudah bisa ya. Oke, sudah muncul. Silakan kepada Meliana. Sekali lagi saya ingatkan waktu berada di 10 sampai 15 menit ya. Harap diperhatikan juga waktunya. Sekali lagi saya tekankan waktu dan silakan kepada Meliana.
Terima kasih, suaranya jelas ya.
Oke, coba dites dulu suaranya masuk. Agak kecil ya. Coba Meliana.
Iya, masuk nggak?
Oke, masuk. Ya, silakan.
Terima kasih. Selamat sore semuanya. Terima kasih untuk kesempatan yang telah diberikan. Perkenalkan nama saya Meliana Francisca Dora. Dan tesis saya berjudul Discrimination Towards Racial Change Giving Cons Prejudice Asian Smoker. This research consists of introduction, review of related literature, research design, findings and discussion, and conclusion and suggestion. Background of the study. We are human beings, basically we have the equal rights in our society, but there are always people that have more power over the others, and sometimes the power that they have make them treat the minority less favorably. As the video states, when people tend to identify themselves as one of the superior ethnic groups, they may discriminate other ethnic competitors. Discrimination, according to Theodorson, is the unequal treatment of individual groups on the basis of some usually categorical attributes such as race, ethnicity, religion, social class membership. And discrimination that happens receives some response in this research. For example, withdrawal, resentment, events and
halo Meli, gimana? Ada gangguan kah? Ya, sepertinya Meliana terkendala jaringan ya. Oke.
Okay. Crazy Rich Asians novel written by Nguyen. Akan dilink.
Halo, Meliana, halo. Sepertinya jaringannya terkendala ya?
Iya, aduh maaf ya, suaranya putus-putus kah? Nggak masuk kah?
Ini share screen-nya keluar.
Oh, share screen, oke, okay, sebentar ya, maaf.
Iya, yeah, oke, okay, coba ya, sekali lagi, tidak apa-apa.
Oke. Okay. Sudah ini kah?
Ya, sudah. Silakan coba dilanjutkan ya.
Oke. Okay. Kayaknya ini gangguan.
Oke, okay. Coba kalau saya yang share screen gimana ya?
Boleh, boleh.
Coba
boleh.
Ya. Saya yang share screen kan. Oke. Ya. Oke, okay, tadi sampai di sini ya.
Di langsung nah. Ke yang
bisa terlihat enggak? Oke. Okay. Ya. Ya, silakan dilanjut.
Nah, langsung ke slide keempat aja, Mas.
Iya.
Oke.
Okay. Ini kah?
Iya.
Oke.
Okay. Based on the background of the study, the research questions are: first, how is the discrimination against racial to portrayed in Crazy Rich Asians novel? And second, what are the responses from racial to against the discrimination as shown in the novel? And purposes of the study based on the research question are: first, to describe the discrimination against racial to that portrayed in Crazy Rich Asians novel, and second, to identify responses from Rachel Chu against the discrimination in the novel. Next. Significance of the study. Theoretically, this research may give significance to the researcher to make a better understanding about discrimination that happens in Crazy Rich Asians novel. Well, critically, this research may also give significance to the other researcher who wants to conduct a similar research use Crazy Rich Asians novel. Scope and limitation. The object of this research is limited to the analysis of the novel Crazy Rich Asians written by Kevin Kwan. The focus of this research is to identify narrations, conversations, and dialogues in the novel that portray discrimination towards Rachel Chu and her responses to the discrimination. Next. Selanjutnya. Review of related literature, the concept of novel. According to Gill in Mastering English Literature, he states that novel is a world specially made in words by the author. And Abrams argues that novel has a greater variety of characters, greater complication of plot, and more sustained exploration of character and motive than to do the shorter. Di sini artinya novel itu adalah dunia baru yang diciptakan oleh penulis sendiri berdasarkan dari imajinasi atau bahkan kejadian sehari-hari yang ada di sekitar penulis. Selanjutnya. Character and characterization, according to Gill, character is a person in literary work, and characterization is the way in which a character is created. Well, according to Griffith, characters are the people in narratives, and characterization is the presentation of the trait characters. There are two features of characterization according to Gill. First is telling. Telling means the information about a character conveys through the narration, through the narrator's opinion. And showing, also known as the subtle way of characterization, because the reader needs to do some kind of investigation in order to find about a character. And there are seven ways in showing. First, how the characters speak, how the characters think, the character's appearance, the character's dress, social standing of character, the name of the character, and the action of the character. Discrimination, according to Alport, involves denying individuals or groups of people equality of treatment they may wish, and an overt behavior targeting a person because they belong to a particular group. Jadi di sini maksudnya diskriminasi itu adalah tindakan denying atau menghindari kelompok lain because they belong to a particular group, karena mereka berasal dari kelompok yang berbeda. Selanjutnya. Responses to discrimination. First is withdrawal. Withdrawal is when the victim of the discrimination, they choose to avoid the place or the situation where the discrimination happened. The self-acceptance is about self-acceptance. Pada tahap ini, korban dari diskriminasi, mereka tidak mencoba untuk membela diri, tetapi lebih ke penerimaan diri terhadap tindak diskriminasi. Kemudian verbal confrontation, the victims of the discrimination, they try to, mereka berusaha melindungi diri secara verbal. Kemudian ada physical confrontation, ini juga sama seperti verbal confrontation, but menggunakan aktivitas fisik untuk melindungi diri. Selanjutnya, previous studies, discrimination towards African American women as portrayed in Hidden Figures film written by Lexi Dwi Haryanti in 2019, and Stereotype and Prejudice in Kevin Kwan's Crazy Rich Asians written by Debbie Nadia Maharani. Selanjutnya. Research method. This research is a descriptive qualitative research. The data of this research is mainly from the Crazy Rich Asians novel written by Kevin Kwan, and the data of this research are the sentences, narrations, and dialogues written in the novel that contains discrimination towards Rachel Chu and her responses to the discrimination. Data collection. Dalam mengumpulkan data, the researcher tentu harus pertama-tama membaca beberapa kali objek penelitian, kemudian taking notes, mencatat hal-hal penting yang termasuk ke dalam data, dan mengkategorikan masing-masing data. Data analysis consists of data reduction, data display, and drawing conclusion. Selanjutnya. Findings and discussion. First, discrimination portrayed in the novel through telling. The data is shown in the PowerPoint. Knowing next nothing about this family made Eleanor particularly anxious. How established were they in Taipei society? Exactly were these girls' parents, and how much did she stand to inherit? She needed to know what she was up against. Data ini menunjukkan bahwa Eleanor, personally, she felt anxious about Rachel because Eleanor doesn't know anything about Rachel, who are the parents of Rachel. Because she wants to make sure bahwa orang-orang yang berada di sekitarnya adalah orang-orang yang layak untuk berada di sekitarnya. Selanjutnya. Discrimination portrayed in the novel through showing. Yang pertama adalah melalui ujaran. The data is Parker, don't waste your time. It's obvious Rachel doesn't know anybody. Di sini Francesca melakukan diskriminasi terhadap Rachel dengan mengatakan bahwa it's obvious Rachel doesn't know anybody, to show that Rachel is nobody. Because di kalangan tertentu, penting untuk mengetahui siapa-siapa saja yang berada di lingkungan itu untuk memastikan bahwa mereka bergaul dengan orang yang tepat. Kemudian selanjutnya, character thought, why in the world did she bring Mandarin oranges? Does she think it's Chinese New Year? And why is she bowing like some stupid Japanese geisha? This data shows that Eleanor think that Rachel is an outdated person, seseorang yang kuno. Kemudian biasanya jeruk mandarin ini biasanya dibawa untuk acara tahun baru Cina. Kemudian mungkin si Eleanor ini dia berharap bahwa Rachel will bring something more valuable for her. Next. Character appearance, overconfident and overfamiliar. I would never thought that Nikki would go for someone like that. Diskriminasi di sini terjadi ketika Jacqueline, she said, I would never thought that Nikki would go for someone like that. Because Rachel is, Rachel ini berasal dari keluarga yang secara ekonomi itu ekonomi menengah ke bawah. Berbeda dengan keluarga Nick, that's why she said, I would never thought that Nick would go for someone like that. Kemudian, character traits, the data shown in the PowerPoint. These girls, mereka mencoba untuk merendahkan Rachel by how she dressed up. Karena di sini dijelaskan bahwa Rachel terlihat seperti dia terlalu berusaha berpenampilan seperti orang-orang di sekitar Nick. And I knew it just got that same desperate that all my servants have. The servants, para pelayan di sini berasal dari mainland China. Itulah sebabnya mereka menyamakan Rachel dengan para pelayan mereka. Selanjutnya. Social standing of character. And how much do you get paid a year? I was just curious to know how much a college teacher in America could possibly earn. Di dalam lingkungan tertentu, tentu sangat tidak sopan untuk menanyakan pendapatan seseorang, bahkan ketika pertemuan pertama. Tapi di sini, Nadine bertujuan untuk menjelaskan bahwa you have nothing compared to us. Bahwa kamu itu tidak punya apa-apa dibandingkan dengan kami. Makanya dia tanya, berapa banyak sih bayarnya setahun? Kemudian langsung. Yeah. Responses to discrimination rise out the dressing room. Seperti yang telah dijelaskan bahwa withdrawal ini adalah tindakan yang diambil menghindari. Kemudian kemudian selanjutnya okay, recent sentence, I have heard enough of this. Di sini Rachel memberi respon, dia tidak dia tidak melawan, tetapi lebih ke menerima dirinya sebagai korban diskriminasi. Kemudian selanjutnya verbal confrontation. Di sini Rachel melakukan perlawanan, tetapi secara verbal dia mengatakan bahwa dia muak berada di sekitar orang-orang ini yang selalu berkutat dengan uang, apa-apa dibandingkan, apa-apa itu selalu dikaitkan dengan uang. Selanjutnya. Discrimination portrayed in the novel through showing and telling, showing how the characters speak, how the characters think, the characters' appearance, the characters' traits, the self-esteem of character, the name of the character, and the action of the character. Responses to discrimination that appeared in this research is are withdrawal, resign, acceptance, and verbal confrontation. Selanjutnya. Conclusion, the findings show that discrimination towards Rachel Chu emerged in two ways, those are telling and showing. And in order to face the discrimination, Rachel Chu gave some responses, which are withdrawal, resign, acceptance, and verbal confrontation. But there was no physical confrontation found in this research. Suggestion, the future researcher can discuss the issue of discrimination through the other literary works to be more aware about this issue. And the next researcher can conduct a research which analyzes the background of why Kevin Kwan written this novel using mimetic theory by M.S. Abrams. That's all from me. Thank you for the opportunity. Kembali ke moderator.
Oke, terima kasih untuk Meliana yang sudah mempresentasikan makalahnya. Baik, selanjutnya saya undang Merlin Oktaviani Ruwata. Merlin sudah siap mempresentasikan papernya. Silakan di share screen dulu. Merlin yang share screen atau saya saja? Ah, oke, bisa ya. Oke, okay, baik. Silakan kepada Merlin, waktunya 10-15 menit diefektifkan saja. Terima kasih. Silakan. Halo Merlin, suaranya tampaknya masih belum terdengar. Nah, di unmute dulu, oke. Ya.
Oke.
Nah, sip.
Sudah terdengar,
Mas? Ya, oke. Okay, silakan okay. Lanjut.
Oke. Okay. Thank you. I would like to present my thesis, and the first is the title is a portrayal of Afro-American struggle against racism in Somerville. The next is chapter one about the background of the study. The phenomena are stable, repeatable effects or processes that are potential object of prediction and systemic explanation by general theories and which can serve as evidence for such theory by Woodward in 2000. The next is the phenomena of racism. The phenomenon of racism has existed since a long time ago until now. This phenomenon of racism since the beginning in 1930 until now. It can be concluded that racism phenomenon has occurred for a long time. Next is we are in research question. And the first, my research question is what kinds of racism which are portrayed in Selma film? And the second, how do the Afro-American people struggle against racism in Selma film? We are in chapter two about my theory. And the first is individual racism, and they are institution racism. The first racism, individual racism, is racism which lies within an individual. And the second is institution racism, is racism was formed from an institute. And we are in theory of struggle. According to Peter and Andre, the struggle is the form of power and resistance. And there are three ways of struggle. The first is coercion and refusal. Coercion and refusal is a struggle to carry out imperatives or common communicate between character to the groups. And the second is domination and escape. Domination and escape is a struggle which which describe of Afro-Americans process to getting their rights. And the last is subjectification and creation. Subjectification and creation is a part of a way of struggle. The concept is is to identify which is based on who control the means of identity construction. And the next, we are in research method. The first is research design. The research design of this thesis is qualitative descriptive research. This research describes the struggle of the characters in Selma film through racism theory. This research is also conducted to figure out the struggle of Afro-American against racism represented by the characters in Selma film. The interpretation, the struggle of the characters and the racism were analyzed from the script. Additionally, the representation of the struggle against racism in Selma film is represented through the characterization of the characters. And the next, there is a data and data source. The first, the researcher used a film entitled Selma released in 2014 as a data source. And the second is the data that the researcher used an incident in the Selma film, which shows racism issues and which shows the treatment of Afro-American struggles against racism. Nonetheless, the data in this research will taken by words, phrases, sentences, clauses, and dialogues from the script of the Selma film. Now we are in data collection. The first researcher watching, read script, identifying, finding, and classifying. And the next is data analysis. The first, the researcher took by data reduction, data display, and conclusion. Now we are in chapter four, finding and discussion. The kind of racist actions. The first is individual racism. Individual racism is a racism in the individual, in every person, in one group of racism. The example like this picture and this dialogue. And the first data one is when the earnest white man said to the Dr. King, "Dr. King, may I introduce myself?" Dr. King said, "Yes, of course." And suddenly white man give his hands and landing a punch to the King's head and kick in to the groin to the Dr. King. And one of Afro-American said to Dr. King, "This way, Dr. King, that white boy there hit you." We can see here is a form of individual racism because a white man suddenly give a racist action to the Dr. King, which the Dr. King is a one black people. And the other example is in data two, when Klansman said, "You know what, I hate more than niggers." The Klansman two said, "What's that?" And Klansman one said, "White niggers." That's a form of individual, that also a form of individual racism. The next is the still in the kind of racist action. We are in institutional racism. Institutional racism is a racism was formed from an institute. The example like in data three, when the governor provoked to the citizen of American, and he said, "We will not tolerate a bunch of nigger agitators attempting to orchestrate a disturbance in this stage, not as long as I'm governor." And this is a one form of institutional racism because he from an institution. And the next is we are in struggle of Afro-American action. Now we are in the first way. The first way is coercion and refusal. Coercion and refusal is a struggle to carry out the orders that are communicated between individual into the groups. Example, like when the Dr. King speak in front of 700 African-American people, and he said, we are not asking, we are demanding, give us the vote. And the dialogue shows when the Dr. King speech at the pulpit in church, and this dialogue contains command to support from Dr. King told these 700 people to protest against the government together. And this is the form of coercion refusal struggle. And the next is there are other way of struggle is the domination and escape. Domination and escape is struggle by identify ways with strategies to achieve goals through the action. This picture is one of example of domination and escape. Now we are in subjectification and creation. This way focuses on the struggle by having an advantageous position because it can connect to struggle. Example, when Dr. King said, you are the man demanding your own legacy with each passing day, they will remember you saying wait and I can't unless you act, sir. This dialogue show when the Dr. King has the power to represent all Afro-American to speak to the president, and he advised to the president to take an action as soon as possible before a bad legacy against the president happened, because he always reviews and show down action to solve racial injustice. Now we are in conclusion. The conclusion of this research is about the kind of racism that happened in Selma film can be concluded as to theories such as individual racism and the second institutional racism, and the part two. The way of Afro-American struggle against racism is followed by three ways, such as coercion and refusal, domination and escape, and subjectification and creation. Now we are in suggestions. The first, the researcher gives suggestion to student who wants to focus to analyze the characters in this film, like the main character or several characters. Second, this researcher gives suggestions to any researchers who wants to analyze this film to study a different theoretical approach. Therefore, this film can provide a wider understanding to those who watch this literary work or film. And thank you. That's all my presentation.
Oke, terima kasih Merlin. Bisa langsung ditutup screen-nya. Selanjutnya saya panggil Saskia Magfira Wajdi. Silakan bisa langsung di-share screen PowerPoint-nya dan bisa langsung mulai presentasi. Silakan. Oke. Oke, silakan.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Ada PowerPoint-nya?
Ya, masuk silakan.
Oh, ya. I will present my thesis that entitled Patriarchal Structure and Forms as Portrayed in the Help Film, Chapter 1, Introduction. There are four reasons for me to conduct this study. I'm interested to find out the reason why feminist movement exists if there is nothing wrong with the patriarchal society. I believe that there must be something off about the patriarchal system that triggers the movement, which is laid on the patriarchal structures and forms that are applied in the society. The portrayal of patriarchal structure and forms can be seen clearly in the Help film, because this film shows the lives of women in patriarchal society, especially the experience of Minnie Jackson character. The discussion of patriarchal structure and form are explained through the application of Sylvia Wahlby's theory about patriarchy. There are two problems of the study. What are patriarchal structure that occur toward Jackson in the Help film? This problem aims to find out the patriarchal structure that occur towards Minnie Jackson character. And second, what are the forms of patriarchy that occur towards Minnie Jackson in the Help film? This aims to find out the patriarchal forms. Scope and limitation of study. Scope, the patriarchal system, structure, and forms. Limitation, Minnie Jackson character of the Help film. Chapter 2, Review of Related Literature. This study applies characterization method by Kenney that concern on three methods such as discursive characterization, dramatic characterization, contextual characterization. According to Wahlby, patriarchal structure consists of six basic ideas of how patriarchy works in society. There are patriarchal modes of production that deals with the unpaid work in households that are done by women. Patriarchal relation in paid work that set limits to woman occupation. Patriarchal state to exclude women from the political world. Male violence that dominates and oppresses women. Patriarchal relation in sexuality that treats women as the object of male gaze, and patriarchal culture that defines the standard of gender roles. The second theory of Wahlby is the patriarchal forms that exist in two, private and public. Private patriarchy refers to the practice of patriarchy of home, while public patriarchy oppresses, dominates, and exploits women in all aspects of life. Chapter 3, research design of this study was descriptive qualitative research. Research instrument was the research herself. Data of this study were dialogue and action from the Help film. Data collection were done through the watching the Help film and taking the description of patriarchal structure and forms that were presented in the film. Data analysis of this study applied the method by Mills, Huberman, and Saldana, data condensation, data display, and conclusion drawing. Next, chapter 4, findings. The findings of patriarchal structure that occur on Minnie's character were shown below. First, patriarchal relation in pet work. Data 1, Minnie about the best cook in Mississippi. Minnie could not work as a cook or any other job, but as a maid due to patriarchal relation in paid work that dictates woman occupation should relate to their caring and nurturing nature. Dramatic characterization was based on ambivalent dialogue regarding Minnie description in film. Next, the second patriarchal structure was male violence. Data 3, Leroy, please. Minnie received physical abuse performed by her husband, Leroy. He threw a pen at Minnie. Dramatic characterization was based on Minnie's own dialogue that stirred her plight for not getting hurt by Leroy. Patriarchal forms. The first form was private patriarchy. Data 6, oh Lord, Leroy gonna kill me. The male violence that Leroy performed that towards Minnie was the form of private patriarchy since it happened with marriage. Dramatic characterization was based on Minnie dialogue that she experienced the private patriarchy of male violence. Next, public patriarchy also occurred towards Minnie character. Data I. Now, when did you hear me say I don't want to clean this house? The limitation put towards Minnie option to work other than as a maid show the form of public patriarchy. Because the social system where many lives dictate the woman to work following their standard, the dramatic characterization was based on many words of cleaning the house that referred to work of maid. Next, this study draws two conclusions. The patriarchal structure that occurred towards Minnie Jackson character are the patriarchal relation in patchwork and male violence. The patriarchal forms that occur toward Minnie Jackson character are the private and public patriarchy. And the end of my presentation. Thank you.
Ya, terima kasih Saskia atas pemaparan makalahnya. Bisa minta tolong di stop share?
Oke.
Ya, baik. Dengan berakhir sesi presentasi dari Saskia, maka berakhir pula sesi presentasi di ruang 6 ini. Selanjutnya saya minta ada sesi diskusi, bila ada silakan yang ingin bertanya maupun menanggapi tiga presenter tadi. Saya persilakan.
Saya ingin bertanya, moderator. Sila.
Ya, Gali. Silakan, ya. Gali.
Untuk presenter terakhir, siapa ya? Saskia. Kak Saskia ya?
Iya, Saskia.
Ya. Saya ingin menanyakan terkait dengan patriarki. Mungkin enggak terlalu berkaitan dengan the finding of the research, tapi saya ingin menanyakan sebenarnya apa yang ingin di-achieve atau the purpose dari menyuarakan patriarki. Mungkin pertanyaan sesederhana itu dari saya. Terima kasih.
Ya, terima kasih, Gali. Bagaimana Saskia bisa langsung menanggapi pertanyaan Gali? Halo, Saskia. Bisa mendengar pertanyaan dari Gali?
Apa ya, tadi di sini koneksinya nggak stabil.
Coba, Gali, pertanyaannya seperti apa tadi, Gali?
Oh iya, pertanyaan saya. Iya, pertanyaan saya simpel aja. Apa yang ingin di-achieve apa bahasa Indonesia? Dicapai atau yang ingin diadvokasikan dari menyuarakan patriarki gitu. Karena kan penelitiannya ini terkait dengan bentuk-bentuk patriarki dan struktur patriarki gitu. Tapi apa gitu tujuan untuk menyuarakan isu tersebut? Itu saja.
Oke. Bisa terdengar tidak bagaimana apa tadi upaya ya untuk menyuarakan patriarki atau menyuarakan penolakan terhadap patriarki mungkin ya?
Iya. Yang ingin di-achieve ya? Gitu. Apa yang ingin dituju?
Ya, apa sih yang ingin dicapai dari perjuangan perempuan mungkin ya, dan beberapa pergerakan feminis mengenai isu tersebut, isu sistem patriarki tersebut. Seperti itu, Saskia. Halo Saskia. Wah, sepertinya Saskia tidak terhubung ya. Ya, sepertinya Saskia tidak terhubung. Saskia, halo. Oke. Gini saja. Kalau Saskia belum terhubung, supaya Galih tidak penasaran, mungkin apa yang ingin dicapai suara-suara yang menentang patriarki itu kan sistem yang menganakmaskan laki-laki ya, sistem atau struktur sosial di mana laki-laki itu menjadi penguasa dari segala lini gitu, seperti misalkan aspek ekonomi. Betul. Ya, pemegang kapital dan lain sebagainya, sementara perempuan dimasukkan ke ruang-ruang yang domestik, ke ruang-ruang sempit gitu. Jadi ya tujuan dari isu-isu feminis, tujuan dari pergerakan perempuan yang menyuarakan anti patriarki yaitu supaya perempuan bisa mendapatkan tempat yang setara, supaya ada relasi yang lebih harmoni antara laki-laki dan perempuan. Bukan berarti feminisme itu memperjuangkan perempuan di atas laki-laki gitu ya, perempuan menjadi penguasa dan lain sebagainya. Tidak, tapi yang diinginkan adalah bisa setara di semua lini, bisa harmoni dengan laki-laki, bisa hidup berdampingan harmoni dengan laki-laki. Bukan berarti perempuan menjadi pemegang kapital, tidak. Nah, itu sih yang ingin disuarakan oleh para feminis gitu ya. Nanti isu-isu tersebut bisa kamu cari lebih lanjut gitu ya, dan bisa baca lebih lanjut di beberapa referensi. Mungkin itu yang bisa saya jawab ya untuk menggantikan Saskia yang sepertinya terkendala jaringan. Baik, saya rasa kita cukupkan saja ya sesi diskusi kali ini. Silakan bagi peserta bisa keluar dari room 6 ini, dari break room, breakout room ini, dan bisa kembali ke ruang utama untuk mengikuti penutupan. Dan jangan lupa presensinya diisi, karena di situ sertifikat akan diberikan melalui presensi yang tadi dibagikan di ruangan ini. Terima kasih kepada seluruh peserta yang sudah mengikuti jalannya 3 sesi sampai akhir. Semoga kita bisa bertemu di kesempatan lain. Sukses terus, sehat terus. Saya pamit, terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Terima kasih.
Waalaikumsalam.